Good morning and welcome to the 29th meeting in 2022 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I would ask all members and witnesses to ensure that all their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the National Planning Framework 4. And we will hear today from 3 separate panels of witnesses. And for our first panel this morning, we're joined by Robbie Calvert, who's policy lead on from the Practice and Research Officer of the Royal Town Planning Institute, and Jim Miller, who is the Chair of Heads of Planning Scotland. A warm welcome to you both. I would like to begin our questions. We've got a number of questions from colleagues, and as there's 2 of you, and we've got a nice bit of time, I think we can relax a little bit, but I'll be keeping us to time, of course. So I'd like to begin with a broad overlook. Can you briefly outline your views on the key changes made to the revised NPF 4 draft?
I'll go first. Quite a significant number of changes have been made to this draft. I think the same essence of the framework is there from the previous draft. A number of these changes, I think, for example, with the National Planning Policy section, we counted 427 changes. A couple of them are more substantive, but a number of them are sort of smaller editing points about clarity and consistency, which is something we asked for. So we're broadly supportive of the revised draft framework that's put in front of us. As I say, the essence is similar to the previous draft, especially with that focus on climate change, the climate emergency and the nature crisis as well, which is something we support. If anything, I think more focus is now on those 2 particular areas, which is something that we definitely support as well. I think at a high level, we would support the committee in their report to Parliament for the approval. This framework has been delayed. I think a lot of that's been out with our hands, COVID and whatnot. A lot of planning authorities, and I'm sure Jim will fill in on this, have been waiting to proceed with their local development plan preparation, and we're waiting to have this national framework in place to do that. Having said that, and there's a number of issues we still have, and that's around resourcing, the delivery programme. We'll maybe come back to those through the questioning. I'll just leave it there for now.
Thanks very much. And Jim, what are your thoughts?
I think we're welcome the publication of the draft NPF4. We're pleased in the improvements in terms of context and content, clarity, consistency and detail. We welcome the firm focus on climate and nature crisis, just as Robbie has said, linking across all of the policies. And it's much clearer there, the key focus. But just as Robbie said, we have concerns about resourcing and upskilling. And I'm sure you've heard this from us before in terms of initial responses to consultation. The plan brings in a number of new requirements for local planning authorities. It states in the delivery programme that local planning authorities are key stakeholders in delivering the NPF4, but we have strong reservations about the resources and the skills sets that our authorities will have. We have been working furiously behind the scenes for over the last 2 weeks since the plan was delivered to Parliament on the 8th of November. Indeed, we had 3 open sessions with over 200 colleagues, planning officers from across Scotland attending these open sessions, representing 34 planning authorities. And it shows the commitment, I think, from the planning authorities that we want to get this right. And I think our key concern is the timing. There just seems a bit of a race to the finish line here. And in inquiring from colleagues in the Scottish Government, it seems the procedures are not in place to allow further change. And we would have liked that, just a short pause to make some tweaks and changes to ensure that we have a document that is more legally robust and less challengeable. Our fear is that some of the policies are in conflict with each other. We'll not go into detail on these today. We'll give you that in the written evidence to follow. But there are concerns that we could find ourselves in appeal situations with these conflicting policies.
Thanks very much for raising that issue. I think that's good to hear, and we welcome the written evidence that you're planning to send to us. Thinking more specifically about the climate and nature crisis, and you both, you know, kind of point, or certainly Robbie, you pointed that out, and their role in the revised MPF4. In practical terms, what does the requirement for decision makers to give significant weight to the global climate and nature crisis mean for development management and development planning across Scotland?
I can start with that. Well, clearly, planning's not a black or white thing, and it's a grey area. We have a planning balance. Additional weight to that is, of course, more emphasis. I don't think that means it necessarily trumps everything in every situation. But I think it's certainly, I mean, in the planning system for the last 20 to 30 years, we've known what we've needed to do in terms of sustainability and climate change, but we've not necessarily had that strength of policy framework nationally to really support that decision making. There will be some difficulties, and I think Jim's touched on that already in terms of this kind of transition into this new framework, and I think particularly for development management planners, you know, some concern what Jim's saying and what Hops have picked up on sort of legal challenges. But certainly regarding the climate emergency policy, that's one thing that Scottish Government have set out in their delivery programme that they're going to supply guidance for. And I think that's going to be one of the more immediate pieces of guidance that will get issued. I think a lot of that around the kind of emissions assessment, which is a sort of new kind of part of the policy coming through there, or certainly a new duty on development management planners. Regarding the nature crisis, we are expecting the Developing with Nature guidance, which was also consulted on last year. Again, going back to the actions part of the delivery programme that Scottish Government has set out, that's been sort of touted as short to medium term. So there's actually quite a wide sort of berth there in terms of when we'd expect that guidance. And I think that goes for a number of parts of this framework. Like, there's many parts of the Planning Act that need implemented to support its delivery, and a lot of additional information that's needed through guidance. And if you look at the sort of work programme that's set out in the delivery programme, some of that we won't expect in the short term, which is concerning, I think, for development management planners in particular.
It's going to leave people a little bit in the dark around decisions that are probably going to come forward quite quickly. Jim, have you got any thoughts?
Yeah, I think I'll pick up on just that last point as well. The gaps and when we can expect the regulations and the guidance which will inform the policies is a key concern, because interpretation therefore will be open to others. And I'll give you an example that already we have colleagues being asked by the Department of Environmental Appeals, Planning Appeals, for a consideration of MPF4 in current applications. So we've already been faced with challenges of how to interpret those policies and being asked to give evidence to the reporters unit on current cases, never mind when the plan is actually adopted. So that we are a wee bit in a vacuum with that. But going back to the substantive point which you asked was how are we placed in terms of climate crisis. I think, again, what Robbie said, planning has been at the forefront of sustainable development for as long as I can remember. And I can go back to 76 Strathclyde Regional Plan, when brownfield development was first mooted, in my recollection. So I think we're comfortable with that. It will simply be the challenges that we receive in terms of interpretation of policy and how we can, as I said already, skill up our officers to address that challenge. I would also say it's not just the planning system is wide-ranging. So we have the key agencies, we have other statutory consultees, we have internal services, and we have the developer side, the applicants. All of those will face the same challenges to ensure that they are on the same page as us so that we can have an effective planning system. We all want to see the planning system delivered. We don't want to have barriers thrown in the way with challenges on it. So I think that was why we said at the outset, if we had time to pause and just make further changes to it, that would have been a benefit to all. But I do recognise that if it was open for a further stage of consultation, then it would all be open to every bit of challenge, which is, I can understand why that's the situation.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for that. Okay, we're now going to move to a question from Mark Griffin, who's joining us online.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning. Given the economic turmoil, there's understandably been a lot of focus on economic growth from government and in Parliament. I just wanted to ask witnesses whether they're confident that the draft NPF4 will encourage, enable and essentially drive sustainable economic growth.
Given my development management experience and policies, a range of policies, some are counter to others, and it's down to the decision maker and what weight they give to those policies. What the NPF will do is inform LDPs, and it's basically up to the local planning authorities what weight and what importance they give to those policies within the key focus of the climate change actions. I think, you know, there will be scope, and hopefully there will be plenty of scope for local authorities to set their own agenda, and it won't be a top-down approach. I'm comforted if you look at the housing figures, for example, and that's part of economic or sustainable economic growth. The plan has minimum tenure figures, and that leaves it to local authorities to decide whether they want to go above or stick to those minimum figures. So that flexibility for authorities, as I think, is key to ensure that we have a sustainable system.
Yeah, I think we'll come back to this later on. I think, and we've said this all along, a lot of this lies in the implementation of this framework, not just its preparation. So if we look at the delivery programme and some of the delivery mechanisms that are touted in that, which I think will be pretty fundamental to sustainable economic growth, but that's alignment with, for example, the infrastructure investment plan. I think that's particularly important to look at some of the newly established place planning and infrastructure advisory group, and how they will interact with the next iteration of the infrastructure investment plan. We've said all along we want a capital investment programme published alongside the framework, like we've seen in Ireland. That's not happened. So now we've got to really make sure that this lines up with the next iteration of the infrastructure investment plan, but also the strategic transport projects review 2 and the national strategy for economic transformation as well. So it's maybe a little bit out of sync with the last two that I mentioned there, in that they're already published. They do have action programmes, though. So we want to see the next iterations of those action programmes lined up with the delivery programme as set out here as well. I think we'll come back to that maybe in more detail. It is good to see the Infrastructure First policy. We would have liked maybe better alignment with the Infrastructure First policy in the actual delivery programme or the infrastructure part of that. But that could be an important step forward in terms of ensuring that we've got the right infrastructure in place for sustainable economic growth. There is a resourcing part of that, and we're yet to see the regs or the final regs and guidance of the local development plans, which I imagine will be doing a lot of the heavy lifting in regards to the Infrastructure First policy. So there's still some unknowns here at this stage. But I'll stop there.
Thanks, Robbie. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey with a supplementary on this question.
Thanks very much, Convener. Jim, you mentioned the local development plans there, and so did you just then. Robbie, is there a pressing need, urgency, do you think, for local planning authorities to review their LDPs, particularly where there may be references in the new NPF4 that are perhaps not contained within the current LDPs that they have? So is there a need to revise and review these as soon as they possibly can?
Softly spoken there, I missed most of the question, but I think it was...
It's on the local development plans. Do you think there's a pressing urgency for the planning authorities to revise these, to get them into fit enough local shape? Because there's provisions in the new NPF4 that would impact on the local development plans.
So my own authority, if I take that as an example, we have paused preparation of our new LDP, awaiting the LDP guidance, which is to come... onto the delivery programme that will be in the short term. So we took the decision, I think quite rightly, that we have re-timetabled our delivery of LDP and moved it back some 18 months or so, so that we can take account of the guidance which flows through. There is a requirement for the LDP to align with the MPF. Until we saw that 2 weeks ago, we would have been in a bit of the dark to exactly take a step forward. We have been working behind the scenes, and I'm sure other authorities have as well, to ensure that we're ready to go. If you then roll that forward, are we looking at 34 LDPs all coming forward at the same time? And when we talked earlier about resources, that will be a resource implication for our colleagues in the reporters unit when those evidence reports start to flow. So there is a concern about a backlog and a slowdown of the planning system. And going back to the earlier question of sustainable economic growth, we all want to see that. But if we have plans that are being delayed, then there is a concern there.
Thanks, Jim. Anything to add to that, Robbie?
Yeah, I mean, I would absolutely agree with the resourcing point there. I think we're also concerned that all the LDPs set off at once, and maybe we'll have to manage this in a smarter, more pragmatic way, even if that series of LDPs setting off, so we don't get 34 evidence reports all at once, which will create issues, well, for the planning authorities, for the reporters unit, which we're also concerned about resourcing and some of the sort of real-term cuts that they're anticipating over the next 3 years, but also all the key agencies as well, and even the private sector would struggle to respond to 34 evidence reports all at once. So could be the case that we have a trailblazer group here, for example, and then learning is taken from then, and then other LDPs set off as and when we think we can actually have the capacity to do that as an industry.
We want to work as collaboratively as possible with the Scottish Government colleagues. We're all professional planners. We want an effective planning system, but we're certainly highlighting some barriers that are coming before us. And we will endeavour to do our best to address those.
OK. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair with some questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. It's good to see you here at the committee. I'm just wondering if you're satisfied that the terms such as community wealth building and 20-minute neighbourhoods are now sufficiently well-defined and understood to provide a robust basis for planning decision-making. And I'll pop it to Jim first.
I think I'll pick up that one. North Ayrshire, my authority as well, based in community wealth building. There are opportunities. There are great opportunities for community wealth building within the planning system. It's maybe not clear, again, with the explanatory notes and the guidance, exactly how that's rolled out. But my experience in delivering those over the past 2 years or so within North Ayrshire is it's achievable and it's deliverable. It's now a policy based in terms of MPF. Therefore, there's a statutory requirement where before it was negotiated on a voluntary basis. But I'm more than content that the planning system is well placed to deliver community wealth building. 20-minute neighbourhood, that there is concern in terms of rural authorities, and I represent an island authority, and what 20-minute neighbourhood means within the rural context. But I think, again, keep you on this word, you know, the lack of guidance and exactly what that means for different populations is key to how we deliver that. And it won't be one size fits all. There will be 20-minute neighbourhoods within the major conurbations. There will be smaller ones within small settlement towns. As long as we don't get fixated on 20 minutes, because 20 minutes is the banner headline. It could be a 10-minute neighbourhood, it could be a 30-minute neighbourhood. The concept is that we have, you know, livable places, that all, you know, everywhere is walkable or is accessible in terms of the 20-minute concept, but don't define it as how quick a walk that is. Then we would get into very minutiae, which we don't want to be.
I'm sure that can turn. Robbie, can you share your thoughts?
Yeah, on both policies, I think they've both improved quite significantly from the previous draft. A lot of clarifications have been made that we asked for, and some of those have been set out in the explanatory report that accompanies the draft. To go back to an earlier point, I think we will get more detail on both of those in the local development plan guidance and regulations. You know, for example, the living well locally and the 20-minute neighbourhood policy and how that was addressed in a rural setting. More detail was added to that in the local development plan guidance. So hopefully that will, you know, support us, you know, through implementing these policies. But yeah, I think both of those policies are vastly improved from the previous draft.
Thank you. Just got one further question. There's kind of numerous references to infrastructure first approach in the revised NPF4. Has this been delivered in practice? And if not, what needs to change?
So the infrastructure first policy, as I understand, hasn't changed a huge amount from the previous draft. So there's some sort of clarifications on the sort of intent behind the policy, but more detail will be in the local development plans for this policy in particular. I think they'll be doing a vast amount of the heavy lifting there. How it works in practice, I think maybe we'll come back to that in terms of the delivery programme and the infrastructure parts of that later on. Don't know if you know.
I think there's a certain disappointment that there's not a capital plan alongside the NPF in terms of delivery. Certainly the indication is that LDP should be aligned to the Council's capital plan and showing how the infrastructure first can be delivered through the LDP. That seems to be missing to date from the NPF, although there is reference to future influence of the infrastructure investment plan. That's not there. There is reference back the way, which seems a bit strange that it has influenced previous plans, and it's not clear to me exactly what that means. There seems to be no new money in terms of the NPF, but maybe that is something that's still to come towards us.
Thanks for your comments. Very helpful. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Marie, and are now going to move to Annie Wells, who also is joining us online. Annie.
Good morning, Convener. Good morning, panel. Every local place plan will have to have regard to NPF4, but looking at this draft, how confident are you that community bodies will be able to do so, and what help might communities need with such a task?
Okay, for local place plans, the approach that we've adopted within, I'm sorry, being parochial here, but North Ayrshire, is to support our communities where we can. But there's a resource implication again for that, and it sounds as though I'm banging the same drum every time here, but it's true. There's been estimated cost up to £10,000 to prepare a local place plan, and that's not a resource that certainly authorities are sitting on when you look at the number of communities that might want to be served by a local place plan. But we have professional planners within all of our authorities who are there to assist, but the devil will be in the detail of how much is required of those local place plans. Not every community will require a local place plan. We have regeneration plans being rolled out just now, part of the Scottish Government initiative for a number of our communities right across Scotland, and they may take the place of local place plans. So it will be a wait and see how much the demand is for those. But we're certainly here to assist.
Just to maybe reiterate that point around resourcing, and I think local place plans is a good example of that. That's something that's come through in the Planning Act, but not necessarily through in the National Planning Framework 4. It's something that is going to be an additional resource burden alongside a number of additional duties that have come through in the Planning Act. So I think when we're considering about any additional work coming to planning authorities through the NPF4, it's good to frame that within the wider scope of the Planning Act 2019 and additional work that's coming through there. I think in regards to local place plans, we've said it all along, there needs to be funding pots for communities to undertake these. Otherwise, we could, you know, potentially get in a situation where we're exacerbating inequalities in our country anyway, with, you know, the well-to-do, the well-off communities with the resource to support the process of preparation, you know, delivering these local place plans, and then other communities not being able to. We see that down in England with neighbourhood plans. Funding is available for them, for example. I think another interesting thing to note from what's happened with neighbourhood plans down in England is that they've been more successful in rural locations than urban. So I can imagine similar patterns happening here, but yeah, big question over the resource in there. I think in terms of how communities interact with the revised draft as opposed to the previous iteration, I think it is more user-friendly. There is a how-to guide that's been put in the annex, for example, and some of the additional information that was kind of upfront in the previous draft has now been annexed. So for me, it's a easier to work document. So I think at least from that perspective, it should be a bit more user-friendly. Doesn't mean there's not going to need to be resources to support people through this.
I think one of the things that Hobbs would like to see is maybe a summary, maybe in plain English. So when we are dealing with stakeholders like with local place plans, it's an easier read and it's not just a document for professional planners. But certainly I agree with Robbie, it's certainly more user-friendly than the previous version.
Thank you very much, panel, and thank you, convener. That's me. Thank you.
Thanks, Annie. Just on that local place plan piece, how will it all fit together? There's a local development plan, and that's great that, you know, Jim, you were talking about how you've paused them. What's the sequencing there? And will communities, how do we get communities on board and kind of alert to the opportunity of making a local place plan? And then how does that feed into the local development plan? Is there a timing on that?
It's already out there. So we already have communities active in preparing local place plans. Those local place plans will have to align with the NPF. So you know, they're very much at the kind of formative stage, evidence gathering, you know, what they want to see in their local place. And when that starts to come to fruition, and it will take a while. You know, I could guesstimate 18 months or so, but it may take longer than that. It will have to sit in the context of the NPF as well, in the same way the LDPs will as well.
Right, but the plan also needs to sit inside the context of the LDP as well, to some extent, or totally.
If you take, you know, what comes first, you know, in my opinion, it might be subject of legal opinion, is that with the NPF being adopted, it takes primacy in terms of the development plan, and every other plan has to follow in line with that.
Okay.
So the local place plans are, in my opinion, no different from that.
Right, okay. And the ones that have been being developed already will need to maybe go back and reconsider some of what they've been doing in light of the
I don't see these being as mature enough at that stage to have to be revisited, but certainly they would have to take account. And maybe that's why the point I raised earlier to the earlier question was maybe an easier read, a summary of the document,
yes,
and a guidance for communities who are not professional planners that would assist.
Yeah, I'm just aware locally by me, there's a, you know, we've been at, the town near me has been very busy on what would not have been called a local place plan because those didn't exist for quite some years, and very good work that they're doing. But now they're probably going to have to go back and have a look and see how it works with the NPF4.
You
know. Could be. OK, we're going to bring in questions from Paul McLennan.
Yeah, thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I was going to ask two questions. The first one was really on talking about the delivery programme, and it's mentioned in about obviously the establishment of planning infrastructure and place advisory group. You kind of both touched on that, but I don't know if there's anything else you want to add on that. The second question was around about one of the things as a committee we were quite keen on was monitoring the implementation of NPF4 over the number of years. We've seen how much things have changed in the last 10 years, so we're keen to monitor how effective it is over the next number of years. So are there any indicators or issues you think the committee should be paying particular attention to in that regard?
So, Jim, as Robbie said earlier, the formation of a planning infrastructure and place advisor group and the commitment to monitoring and evaluation are important key elements as far as HOPS are concerned. We wondered if there was a role for this committee in terms of monitoring the work of that group. The delivery programme references a board, and it's not clear from the delivery programme what constitutes a board. And it does seem to me a bit reinventing the wheel when you already have a committee who could be there to evaluate and monitor, but not being familiar with parliamentary procedures, that might be not competent. But it does strike me that there is a role there for this committee in monitoring and evaluating. It does say in the delivery programme it would be revisited after 6 months, which I think is welcome, and then it's annual review. Exactly what you're going to monitor is a bit unclear, because the policies will still be at their kind of formative stage, but maybe you could start to pick up and take evidence on the impact of the policies through, you know, planning appeal decisions, through LDP progress. There's a number of areas that could be monitored even within the first 6 months. But maybe I'm giving you too big a job to take that
one. I think, Jim, it's certainly in discussions within the committee. That was one thing we were really keen to do, to make sure there was ongoing monitoring right throughout the 10 years sort of thing. You mentioned resource, for example, and I know I'll come into Robbie, but I think, you know, for example, is that one thing, you know, from Hobbs' point of view, you talked about, because from one local authority, one of the key things that was mentioned was about the additional training that was worked, for example, the carbon measurement was something that local authorities all need to try and pick up. And there's an obvious additional training and no additional resource, yep, in terms of that as well. So that was an issue that was raised in terms of that. So resource, I suppose, would be one, I would take that would be one measurement you would like to see over that number of years, as would Robbie probably, and I'll come on to Robbie in a second. But if there's any other specific things that you would like to see from the Hobbs point of view, from this committee to look at, probably one from your own perspective of heads of planning, but also that much broader measurements within the...
Again, there is a commitment. Sorry, kind of well, yeah, your documents already. There is a commitment within the delivery programme for the Scottish Planner, government planners, to move from delivery, from policy development to policy delivery.
Yeah.
Policy delivery, to me, strikes, you know, there should be working with the local planning authorities in terms of training and upskilling, as we said earlier. There is a commitment within there to improve. There's a reference to one of the recent training programmes, yep, as an example. I think it was in hydrogen. It's actually specifically referenced. So that's a commitment from the Scottish Government to reflect on that. We have the improvement service we use to upskill planning officers. We're going through a programme of carbon literacy just now, funded by HOPS through our own funds. So, you know, there's a joint commitment there to training. And perhaps that's something that could be evaluated and monitored as we go along.
Okay, appreciate that. Robbie, I know you and I have had discussions before about recruitment and resource and so on. So I don't know if you want to add anything about the delivery programme, then more about the group, and obviously the key measurements that you would want to see as well.
Yeah, so I'll start with the delivery programme. I mean, there is actually a resourcing question about the delivery programme itself, for yourselves and all stakeholders here. I don't think that was part of the business and regulatory impact assessment that accompanied the revised draft MPF4. So I think there is a question about that. I think for the advisory group, the planning infrastructure in place advisory group, there's two really important roles there. And I'd say the first one's the one I mentioned earlier about the infrastructure investment plan and having that key influence there. It's something we understand, that's the intent, but in terms of detail, and I think that's maybe an issue more broadly with the delivery programme, it's just not there. And how we want to see that work. And there is a really interesting little paragraph here right at the start of the delivery programme, which says the delivery programme focuses efforts across the Scottish Government to ensure alignment across national plans and programmes. This alignment will be an iterative process building over time. So I think, firstly, that is a really important thing to monitor. And I think there'll be a role here for the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee with the annual kind of reporting procedures that you'll put in place, is to see not only how is the MPF4 aligning with, you know, existing plans and strategies, but how new plans and strategies coming on board are taking consideration of the MPF4. So I think that's something really important that we need to look at over time. I think in terms of the kind of oversight and monitoring bit, there is a sort of brief part of the delivery programme where it discusses some of the sort of key stakeholder groups that this advisory group will interact with. So that's the high level group, that's the key agencies group, the infrastructure delivery group, Scottish Government. We would add the Local Government Housing Planning Committee to that. But also we'd add the Office of, we call it the Office of the National and Planning Improvement Coordinator, which actually in the delivery programme is fairly quiet. I think it is mentioned in terms of oversight, but we think that could be maybe brought more to the fore. We are waiting guidance on it, and I think that will come in the short to medium term if you look at the actions part of this delivery programme. But we see that position, and we see it as an office, not one role, because it's actually quite a big job to monitor and review the entire planning system. So that's why we call it the office, because, you know, we're basically being clear about the kind of resourcing that it does need. And in our written evidence, we've linked to a think piece that we've done on the matter. So yeah, we think that would also have a crucial part of the kind of oversight. I think what Jim's already mentioned about the kind of review of the delivery programme itself coming in the next 6 months, I'd be interested to hear how the committee will interact with that review. How will you be out of sync with your kind of annual reporting, or will there be an opportunity for the committee to get involved with the delivery programme at that six-month mark or just before that, so that you can have some oversight of it as well. And we'd obviously welcome our involvement with that process.
Okay. Any other indicators, Robbie, that you would like to see?
Indicators?
You've mentioned quite a bit there already. But
yes.
One more.
Yeah, of course.
Fairly obviously, national developments.
Yeah.
So national developments sit mainly with the Scottish Government to deliver. A bit worrying when it says in the development plan that development plan states that the funding for national developments still needs to be agreed and factored in. So we have a plan about to be adopted to deliver national developments, but the funding still needs to be agreed and factored in. I would query exactly what that implies. It appears it's a work in progress, which is not really what we want to hear, and perhaps that's something that could be reviewed in 6 months. Has it been agreed and factored in?
And I think the key thing you mentioned, it's an iterative process. You know, we need to be making sure it's a living document going through the next 10 years, even in the next 6 months to a year sort of thing. So, no, that's been really helpful.
Can I just come back? Yeah.
On the indicator part, there is quite an interesting section in the delivery programme around indicators itself, and so that's section 5 there, but under the spatial strategy, and there's all sorts put forward there. I think you have this issue with, you know, it takes a long time for development to come out of the ground, so policy changes now could take 5-10 years before we can really monitor them effectively or not. But there's a table there with some really interesting ideas, you know, Scottish greenhouse gas inventories, journeys by active travel, satisfaction with housing. So it's actually quite an interesting bit of work that's been done there. And that's been lined up with some of our outcomes work that we published a couple of years ago now.
Yeah. Robbie, thank you for that.
Good. Thanks
for
being for the point.
Yes.
There's new duties that have been added in. And I think we've, in our written evidence, we will be itemising those new duties and where policies have been substantively changed. And one that, when we had those three open sessions, one that kept on coming up was suicide. So how spatial planning has to address a policy on suicide is a question mark. I don't want to take up the time debating that, but there are new areas that have been reduced to the planning authorities, which we have concern about how we can actually deliver that. Okay. And it raises an expectation within our communities that we can make those changes. If we don't have the tools or the skills or the ways to make those changes, then it lessens the impact that planning could have.
Yeah. Thanks, both. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Paul. Jim, I just wanted to say I was really impressed. You did say it at the beginning, and you just said it again, that you know, you've already been so busy since this has come out and bringing together all these planners for these, you know, discussions and you know, questioning how this is going to work in the sector. And I think that's fantastic and kind of poignant that you bring in this piece that planning and how we decide to have our built environment can affect, you know, somebody's decision to choose to live. So I think that's, you know, tremendous, and it would be great to see the planners in general anyway resourced properly. I'm going to now bring in Miles Briggs with some questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thanks for joining us this morning. I wanted to ask some specific questions with regards to land supply. And to kick off with, do you think MPF4 as it stands will actually bring forward the future development sites we need to meet our Housing 2040 target?
I think that will be down to the individual authorities, and I think, as I referenced earlier, the approach in the housing policies is one where it leaves it to the local authorities to determine what they want to see brought forward. You know, there's no prescription as such within the NPF. You know, it's minimum numbers. So if your authority are ambitious and being parochial again, our authority is very much based on growth, and we saw opportunities to add to our housing land supply, working collaboratively with Homes for Scotland and other stakeholders. So that opportunity is still there for authorities to adopt at a local level.
So the housing policy, I don't think, has seen fundamental changes from the previous iteration. I think more clarifications than anything. I think there's definitely been a shift in terms of the importance and weight put on the allocation of land in the local development plans. And again, we're expecting to see more colour coming through with the final regs and guidance on that. So I'd probably need to see that before I could fully answer your question. I think what we'd said previously to that policy is that we want to see sort of clear and consistent approach to housing numbers, and I think deriving them locally has been quite a resource challenge for a lot of local authorities. So there might have been a bit of variation across the country of how fully that was fulfilled, and a lot of that does come down to resourcing. We definitely highlighted the role for the Scottish Government's Digital Planning Task Force here in supporting the kind of evidence base that we need for that. But we certainly wanted to see the kind of shift more to with housing land supply, about the sort of how the methods at which we assess the deliverability of sites, and then the mechanisms to review housing land supply. So we want to see the conversation move on over that way. And importantly as well, obviously, how can we deliver quality development too in the right amounts? So as I say, yeah, a little bit of colour there to come from the LDP regs and guidance, and obviously a big question mark over resourcing the planning system as a whole as well and helping implement this framework.
Thank you for that. In terms of how this has been developed in England, they have a strategic housing land availability assessment looking towards a 15-year availability of land for housing. Now, I don't see in terms of MPF4 what that looks like. In my own area here in Edinburgh, it's based on brownfield sites, 90% of which have businesses currently on them who have no ideas where they're going to be moved to. So do you think it would have been useful to have that longer term 15-year at least vision of where homes might be built?
I have no strong opinion on that. I think the system we have with the 5-7 year supply has worked successfully over preceding years. It might be open to challenge by other stakeholders, but from a planning and service perspective, I've got no problem with that. The focus for MPF4 is on climate change. It's on net zero. So the encouragement of brownfield development is bringing that to the forefront is very welcome as far as I'm concerned. It's been a platform of planning over many years and seems to have lost its way, in a personal opinion. So bringing that back to the fore and reusing existing brownfield sites, to me, is a far better approach and a stronger approach to bring sustainable economic development.
Mm-hmm. I'd probably go back to that previous point I made about the reviewing of housing land supply. And as we move to a system of sort of 10-year MPF4 and 10-year LDPs as well, how a 5-year housing land supply is reviewed within that and the delivery programme of an LDP, I think, is quite a critical consideration.
Yeah, thank you. And just finally, you both mentioned the expectation of additional information within the guidance around this. I had specifically said I thought we needed some sort of mechanism within MPF4 to review this to make sure that land is actually forthcoming. Do you think that is available? You've obviously pointed towards what we as a committee maybe could start looking at, but do you think that guidance should include potentially that?
In the round, as we've both said, you know, the delay in issuing the guidance is of concern. Development programmes pushes some into the medium term, not exactly clear what the medium term is, but if you look at it, regional spatial strategies, open space assessments, place sufficiency assessments, LDPs in particular, all of those have been brought forward in the 2019 Act, and we don't have the guidance as yet on how we can deliver those, so that they're all on pause just now.
Yeah.
As I say, I think the reviewing of housing land supply will be predominantly undertaken within the LDPs. Having said that, sort of back to that question about the delivery programme for the MPF4 and some of the metrics there, housing statistics have been, listed as one of the elements that we could look at. I think there's parts of that could get explored.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Kamina.
Thanks, Miles. I'm going to bring Annie Wells in. All right. So we're going to bring in Paul McLennan with additional questions.
Yeah, thanks,
and then
Kamina.
Annie.
Just one question. I mean, it's been raised a few times about Policy 27, about out-town development in terms of that, and probably clarity from developers in that regard. I'm just wondering, in terms of your interpretation of that, and both of you in terms of that, in terms of, do you see enough clarity in that regard for out-of-town developments and where the balance comes in and that? So we I think we've heard representations, let's say, from quite a number of bodies in that regard. I just wondered what your thoughts were on that regard. Probably yourself, first of all.
We strongly welcome that approach to reduce out-of-town development, the town centre first principle, as we've seen over the last few years with the COVID and the pandemic. You know, the town centres have been very, very severely hit. So readdressing that to re-emphasise, if you like, the town centre first principle is welcome. I think the headline that was made was the banning drive-throughs. If you think of, you know, net zero and reducing carbon footprint, you know, drive-throughs strikes me as an area where we should be opposed and getting people out of cars and into, you know, public transport into the town centres. So that to me is welcome. Again, to a wee bit of ridicule of whether you could pick up your shopping at the supermarket. I think we all know what it means. We're looking at, you know, reducing the number of out-of-town drive-throughs and retail outlets.
Okay. Robbie, on that one?
Yeah, just to slightly correct Jim there in terms of the, because I know the media picked up on this kind of ban and drive-throughs. I mean, it's something we said in response to the previous draft that we wanted to see, you know, a higher threshold in terms of where we would permit the drive-throughs or not. I think it's a limitation on drive-throughs unless they're specifically supported in the LDPs. So just maybe a slight nuance to that. I think this whole policy has been somewhat rationalised. I think that's more sort of user-friendly, you know, with including the town centre kind of living approach that we saw in the previous draft, but that's been sort of incorporated here as well. And I think some amendments were made there in terms of trying not to direct residential development to sort of ground floor shops. So we are supporting that sort of town centre first approach.
Yeah. So yes. Just until, I mean, again, the issues that have been raised, is there enough flexibility in terms of the capacity for local situations? And again, obviously, if an out-town might depend on, you know, what's the local situation within that. And again, Jim, I don't know particularly from yourself, do you think from a planning point of view, from a planner's point of view, there is that flexibility within the policy that's been indicated here that would give you that? Because it's not one size fits all, obviously, in terms of each out-of-town development. But I just wondered what your thoughts were on, does that still give you enough flexibility within the system or within in regards to taking an individual
consent? I think we said at the start, we welcome, you know, the climate challenge that we have, yeah, and through the policies, the net zero. If you take that approach, then that should inform how you actually lay out your LDP. And I think it states the obvious that we are looking for these step changes and moving away from out of town and focused on the town centres, which we welcome.
Robbie, anything to add on that?
I mean, just to say as well that the policy, one change in it, is certainly strengthened in terms of its support of local neighbourhood shopping, and I think lining up with the kind of 20-minute neighbourhood local living sort of policy approach elsewhere in the framework, and that's something we'd support too.
Okay. Thanks, Camina. Thank you.
Thanks, Paul. And we'll now go to Annie Wells. Annie, I think you've got a question or two.
Yeah, sorry. Apologies, Convener, that I wasn't here before. Do you think that the revised draft MP4 will support or hinder the delivery of the level of renewable energy developments needed in Scotland to achieve net zero?
I think it's very supportive. It introduces, for the first time, a whole range of renewables, which are welcome. One of the conflicts we saw earlier was there seems to be policy against development within wildland areas, national scenic areas, but then the renewables policy says that these can be considered in any area. So these are the kind of clarity areas we want. We want to protect, obviously, these wildland areas and national scenic areas, and at the same time we want to support renewables. But the fact that they have introduced, the policy has introduced a whole range of them, we're not simply focused on wind energy now. We can be looking at a whole range of other renewables that are available to us.
So this policy, as I understand, is one of the policies that has had more substantive change from the previous iteration. I think picking up on Jim's point there, there is now a sort of more permissive wording regarding the delivery of onshore renewables in wild land areas. I think just to be clear as well, I mean, the intent behind that is to meet energy targets, and I think the renewable industry would be broadly welcome those changes. But just to be clear as well, like any development on a wild land area would still be subject to impact assessments and appropriate mitigation and management measures and monitoring as well. So, yeah, I think this sort of reflects the kind of change in the scale of development that we require to get to net zero. There still is protection for national scenic areas and national parks within that. But that's certainly a policy area that's seen quite a big shift. I would go back to resourcing again, and in particular the resourcing of the reporters unit. They're seeing a huge uptick in Section 36 applications at the moment that are going to inquiry. So if we're cutting the funding for them as their workload's going up, I could see that being a big problem when we think about implementing the kind of net zero agenda, even with a more permissive kind of policy framework in place.
Thank you, convener. I think the answer. Oh, sorry.
Dori, when you go first.
She was just closing. No, I was just going to say, put in the wild land aspect as well, and I was just wondering, obviously, from the questions and the answers that Robbie gave, do you think that the draft MP4 does address these concerns wholeheartedly? Do you think we are taking into account wild lands and renewables and giving them the same sort of a footing?
Reference back to the point made earlier, I think with a bit of clarity to those policies, and that could be brought out, and we wouldn't find ourselves arguing over, you know, which policy is the stronger one. I know what I have in my mind, but that might not be with the rest of my committee. The point of renewables, and I think it's, you know, the planning system is wide-ranging. Planning can't deliver all of the renewables. If you just simply look at grid connections, and I'm sure the committee have considered that before, we could be granting planning consents for renewable projects, but if the grid connections are not there, which is out with our control, then these can't be delivered. So that just another example of where the planning system can only go so far to make those changes.
Maybe just come back to the resourcing point, but particularly in planning authorities themselves, in terms of onshore wind applications, they tend to be, you know, there are more significant major applications coming through which require possibly more senior planners to get involved with them. There's a bit of a dearth of that in the industry at the moment in terms of sort of 10 years in senior planners. So there's definitely an upskilling there, I think, in terms of our existing planning workforce, bringing them up to speed so they can undertake this work, but also the capacity of internal expertise, for example, landscape officers, which are a crucial part of this kind of due diligence when it comes to the kind of impact assessments, like landscape and visual impacts assessment, land capacity studies and whatnot that comes alongside these applications. So I think massive area of consideration there is the resourcing and the skills, which I think are directly tied in with one another.
I think added to that final point there is just the pending shortage of planners within Scotland. You'll be aware of the high-level group's consideration of the Future Planner Project, which estimates some 700 planner shortfall over the next 10 years. Whilst we're working with the Scottish Government and academia to address that, it's something we have to flag up with all these new duties that are coming forward to councils. And having that level of skill to deliver the policies that we wish to see.
Thank you, convener. Thank you very much, Anna.
Thanks, Annie, for those questions. So we've come to the end of our questions. We've got a few more minutes. If there's anything that you think we haven't covered that you really think is really important for us to just really hear, that would be welcome. So, Jim, I think you...
Yeah. I think we touched on earlier the transitional arrangements. I mentioned earlier how colleagues are already finding DPEA asking for commentary on policies which haven't exactly been finalised as yet. A chief planner letter, hopefully the committee's familiar with the chief planner letter, would be welcome to give guidance to authorities on how we deal with those transitional arrangements until adoption. How material is the MPF policy in respect of planning decision making? have a planning committee meeting in January, and I'm already asking the officers to consider the assessment against the MPF. That's just to future-proof me, but it'd be better if we had some guidance, and a chief planner letter might be the way forward.
Thanks for that. And Robbie?
I've got two final points. I mean, sorry, back to resourcing, but one thing we maybe took issue with was the business and regulatory impact assessment, which the kind of summary sort of distilled, well, ran along the lines that the planning authorities would save, well, there'd be a lot of potential savings from the local development plan preparation process, now having these national planning policies. But actually, drilling down into the table itself, I think we identified 14 different areas where there's new workloads coming online potentially for planning authorities. And we actually felt that might have been a slight underestimate as well in terms of how that was worked through. So I'd just like to reiterate what we've asked for previously, which is a comprehensive skills and resourcing plan to be a part of the delivery programme, or at least the next iteration. But my final point would be around the sort of corporate influence of this plan. We're going to have a full parliamentary debate on it. I think that's a great opportunity to, you know, put planning to the front of our, you know, consideration as a country, and to really get MSPs on board about what this framework can mean for the whole country, but their constituencies as well. Just pointing to an Irish example of their National Marine Framework, but when that was published, the entire cabinet there set out the relevance of the framework to their various portfolios, and we really like that approach. So I'd like to see that come through in any report to Parliament, is to really ensure that we get that buy-in, and we use this opportunity to do that. Also, we need to do that in local government as well. I think chief planning officers and the statutory guidance that's to be prepared for that is a good opportunity, and that's something we want to maybe see a bit more strongly in the next iteration of the delivery programme as well, setting out that important link that they provide into the sort of corporate decision-making part of local government. I'll stop there.
Okay. I'm glad I asked if you had any more to say, because they were very important points, I think. That's quite interesting about the National Marine Plan, the Irish National Marine Plan, that the Cabinet Secretaries had to kind of say in the chamber, I assume, how their framework was going to affect their particular areas of work. And certainly we have heard loud and clear around the requirements for resourcing and skills development in relationship to this. But I just want to say, I really appreciate you coming in this morning. And it's clear that I see from Jim's copy of the National Planning Framework, they're all, yeah, with all of the little stickies in it, that you have been drilling down deeply. Yes, I know, right? This is kind of, these are the things that are going to shape Scotland over the next 10 years. It's such important work. So thank you so much for sharing your organisation's views with the committee this morning. And I now suspend the meeting for 5 minutes to allow for a change of witnesses. We'll now begin our second panel of witnesses this morning, and on panel two, we're joined by Elsa Raeburn, who's the Chair of Community Lands Scotland, Claire Simmons, who's the Founder and Chair at Planning Democracy, and Bruce Wilson, who's the Head of Policy and Advocacy at the Scottish Wildlife Trust and is appearing on behalf of Scottish Environment Link, and they're joining us online. And we are joined in the room by Liz Hamilton, who's the Director of Planning at Homes for Scotland, and Morag Watson, who's the Director of Policy at Scottish Renewables. And I welcome you all this morning to the session, maybe a long-awaited for session. So I'd like to begin with a broad overlook and just hear from you all I'd just like to hear your views on any of the key changes made to the revised MPF4. I'll begin with Morag.
Very much. Good morning, committee, and it's great to be here. Thank you for inviting Scottish Renewables to give evidence. So I think last time I sat before you and gave evidence on the MPF4, we were very unequivocal that the draft that was presented then would not help Scotland reach net zero, and it would undermine our ability to deploy the amount of renewable energy we would need to hit our climate change targets. And I'm now delighted to be able to sit in front of you and say there's been a remarkable turnaround in the document. I would very much like to commend the Planning Minister and his officials in the Chief Planner's Office. They have done a huge amount of work. They've obviously listened very carefully to the feedback they were given and to the expert input that was put into the process. And it's our view now that the document as presented to Parliament probably represents one of the most supportive planning regimes for renewables in the whole of Europe. But I would like to be clear, it does not give a free pass to any development in any place. What we wanted as an industry is we want very much to maintain the integrity and the standards that we have here in Scotland. And what we asked for was a set of very clear and ambitious tests that any development should have to pass in order to be able to gain consent. And that's what we have. What we had asked for was clarity around these tests where they were unambiguous. And again, that is the place that we have arrived at. So I would commend the officials who have worked extremely hard on this. The document they have produced in terms of what it says around renewable energy is extremely good.
Thanks for that, Morag. I'm just going to say a little bit more about process because we've got some folks online, some people in the room. So if you want to come in, if you're online, for this question I'm going to ask all of you just because we want to get the kind of foundational views. But in other questions, we'll try to direct them. But also, if you want to come in, please put an R in the chat. And I believe, Claire, you have put an R in the chat.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for inviting us again to give evidence. Well, I think really this is one of the most progressive planning strategies since devolution. It's saying things about things that really matter. It's not just about economy and growth, but it says that our climate, nature and well-being actually matters as much. I think the document still needs to be clearer about what is necessary development, what development is important and needed, because the focus on nature and climate implies that we've got to be a lot more frugal with our resources, including land. And it suggests that, development does need to be limited. So we welcome the clearer language, as many people do, and I like the layout and the clarity of the policy principles and the outcomes and the impacts and connections highlighted in each of the policy sections. One thing I did notice was that the planning policy one, which was the plan-led approach to sustainable development, has been deleted. And I don't think there's anything sinister about this because, it's decided that perhaps it's implicit in the planning system. The planning system is generally assumed to be plan-led, and that's what we would strongly support. But there's now only one policy that actually contains a reference to a plan-led system, and this is the housing policy. And it's interesting that in the last 2 years, there have been 115 appeals on refusals for housing developments of over 10 houses. And we've looked at a sample of those, and it appears that around 45% are successful in overturning the decision, the local decision. And importantly, most of these were on sites that were not allocated in the plan, and roughly half of them were designated green belt or greenfield sites. So the number and success of appeals suggests that we don't have a plan-led system, but also that decisions often undermine other planning policies that have now been given more prominence in the MPF 4. So we hope that the housing policy, which has been strengthened to avoid the problems that led to the high level of appeals, because the test of the MPF 4 will be whether or not the approach to housing is plan-led. And we hope that it won't be now continue to be driven by the threat of appeals. So there was also one small typo that I noticed on page 4, which talks about rather than compromise or trade-offs, and I think it's supposed to be on, but we would recommend that this paragraph is deleted anyway, because it says rather than compromise on trade-offs between environmental, social and economic objectives, this is an integrated strategy to bring together cross-cutting priorities and achieve sustainable development. And we think this paragraph rather glibly denies the fact that there will be trade-offs, as the appeals have so, you know, so readily sort of suggested. I mean, it's almost ridiculous to assume that there won't be trade-offs, and that an integrated strategy is not going to prevent that. There's a lot of conflicting policies. I think looking at all the policies, there's at least 60 different judgments that a planning officer might be required to make. So, yeah, I think, you know, that paragraph could be perhaps removed.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Claire. And I believe, Bruce, you want to come in there?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, Scottish Environment Link really want to thank the committee for the work they've done on this, and the officials and the ministerial team as well. We think this is vastly improved. The layout is much, much clearer, and the equal weight that's given to climate and nature in Policy 1 is really, really strongly welcomed. The previous panel were discussing the emphasis that was placed on the climate emergency in this document, and that is great, strongly supported by Scottish Environment Link and the Scottish Wildlife Trust. However, we do want to stress that it is equal weight on the climate and nature emergency, and that really does need to be taken account of when reading this MPF 4. In terms of other things we'd kind of like to bring out within this session, we'd like to discuss slightly the use of will not be supported. There's a few areas that we think we could tighten up the clarity on there. And we would like to discuss policy 4 part G, particularly around the kind of statements around wild land. I agree with the previous contributor that there is strong support for renewables here, but we need to make sure that that's not going to have an impact on biodiversity and nature. And there's some suggested rewording that we have for that section.
OK, thanks, Bruce. Yes, we've got a specific question later on that. And maybe if we've got time at the end, if we haven't addressed anything that folks still want to bring in, I'll try to give us some time for that. Liz, you wanted to come in.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, committee, for inviting me to come and speak on behalf of Homes for Scotland. Firstly, Homes for Scotland would like to commend the committee for the work it's already undertaken on MPF 4. The revised draft has improved from the original in terms of structure and readability of policies. That's quite clear to see. In fact, I think this is the draft we'd like to have seen first. But in terms of other positives, you know, some of the policies now offer greater flexibility, which I think we'll come on to talk about anyway, in terms of local living, 20-minute neighbourhoods, which was discussed in the previous session. We recognise the importance of meeting both the climate emergency and nature crisis head-on through effective use of the planning system. However, alongside this, a balance has to be achieved to ensure that Scotland's housing needs are also central in the decision-making process. With a shortfall in the number of new homes built since 2008, approaching 100,000, we remain disappointed that the housing crisis is still not specifically mentioned, particularly when it is within Scotland's control to fix. It's also worth reinforcing the contribution that new built housing can have to lowering carbon emissions, both through sustainably located developments and the high performance of new homes. Picking up some of the language that's in the livable places section of part one, the National Spatial Strategy, we're very supportive of that. Some of the bits that sort of jumped out to me were, you know, Scotland's population strategy reflects the need for planning to identify the amount of land required for future homes. And planning must also enable the delivery of good quality, affordable homes by allocating enough land in the right locations to meet current and future needs and aspirations. So this is all good stuff. It's also really positive to see the links now to the population strategy, Housing to 2040 and other wider policy documents. However, we do still have significant concerns about the delivery and implementation of the policies with an MPF4 in order to adequately and responsibly address the housing crisis. And really what I come back to is the importance that everybody in Scotland has the right to access a home that's safe and warm, that meets their needs and that they can afford. And I just would like to outline the key concerns. I know we'll probably get an opportunity to cover these, but the key concerns we have, again, touching on the transitional guidance, that will come up in conversation, I'm sure. We'll touch on Policy 16 and the workability of quality homes, how to maintain and assess that deliverable land pipeline will be absolutely critical. The Mackler figures, I would like to touch on that as well in terms of how they've been approached in the Honda system, housing need and demand assessment that sits behind that, and then a bit on the delivery plan and resourcing as well. But it feels like that will come up in conversation anyway.
Thanks, Liz. And if it doesn't, please make sure we hear what you want to say. Elsa, you wanted to come in.
Yes, thank you, Convener, and thank you, Committee, for the opportunity to comment today. From a Community Land Scotland perspective, very much welcome many of the changes that are in the revised draft. I think it's really positive. It's made a great contribution to balancing different interests. We've already talked about wildland and the need to balance the nature and climate crisis with the need for renewables and for small-scale community-led development. So I think the plan has done a really great job in balancing lots of those different interests. I think the explicit policy report, policy support for community wealth building, community ownership and community-led development is really welcome. And I suspect it's probably the world's first national planning framework to specifically reference community wealth building, and that's very much to be commended. So I think the Minister and his team have done a great job in bringing all of these elements together in what is a really difficult economic circumstances and with lots of competing interests. There are three sort of specific areas of concern which hopefully we'll be able to pick up that we still have with the framework. And the first is around rural population and repopulation. And I note Susan's point there about the housing crisis, which is extremely pressing in some rural areas. And hopefully we'll get the opportunity to talk about that later in the committee session around renewables and the missed opportunity around specific community wealth building references in new renewables development. And then finally, what we're seeing in rural areas, in particular around the natural capital driven land markets. And there's no reference to some of those landscape scale changes that are happening as a result of those land market changes within the planning framework, but they're having a huge impact on local communities. So again, if you've got the opportunity to cover those today, that would be welcome. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Elsa. And so that was kind of like the bigger picture. In talking with the Minister, he's, you know, very, very firm about the idea that the National Planning Framework, you know, the priority, and we see that in it now, is climate and the biodiversity or nature emergency and those crises and how we can tackle them. So in practical terms, what does the requirement for decision makers to give significant weight to the global climate and nature crises mean for development management and development planning across Scotland? I open that up to anyone who wants to pick that up. Claire.
Hello. I think I think the question is, do these policies provide enough teeth to give planners the confidence to make bold decisions that will be upheld if an appeal comes along? You know, how will planners' immunities know that the reporter has got their backs on decisions that, for example, support biodiversity policies? You know, what evidence will a reporter be looking for in terms of climate and biodiversity to support decisions that may perhaps limit development or prevent a development because it impacts negatively on climate and biodiversity? And given that all built development will generate climate impacts, I think, you know, what's missing and what we need to agree is how need is going to be defined, and in order to decide what development is going to be restricted. And I'd just like to point to a research paper in Ecological Economics, which explores the expansionist housing policies, primarily in England. They were modelling how much these expansionist housing policies are compatible with national biodiversity and decarbonisation goals. And their model estimates that around 12,500 acres of farmland will be lost per year to urban development in the UK. And this equates to the average loss of biodiversity of about 0.04 species per hectare, or an average of 5.7% loss in species richness in the areas being developed. And with regard to carbon, even the most ambitious carbon reduction scenarios that they ran, including new build, decarbonising new builds and existing stocks, these still used 60% of the cumulative carbon budget required to remain within the 1.5 degree C limit. In other words, expansionist housing policies use up huge amounts of the carbon budget and deplete biodiversity. And I guess my question is, if this plan, if the MPF is built out and delivered, how much does the housing policy use up of the carbon, Scotland's carbon budget? And how will this be assessed and when? You know, are local authorities required to determine the carbon budget or the biodiversity loss at the local development plan stage? You know, will it be up to local authorities to compare emissions on retrofitting using empty homes and the reuse of brownfield sites, compare those to new build on greenfield sites? And do they have the capacity, knowledge and support to do this? You know, how well equipped are our planning officers to make these kind of judgments? You know, we've in previous sessions, we've talked about employing more ecologists and climate specialists to support these planning officers. And maybe that's more when we come to the delivery plan, but I think that's an important part of the process.
Thanks, Claire. So online, we want Bruce and then Elsa and then Morag.
Thanks. I agree with everything that Claire's just said there. I think one of the strongest changes that we've seen in this redraft is there were a lot of shoulds associated with biodiversity previously, and that's been changed to more predominantly will not be supported, and that is a big useful change, we think. We do think there's a couple of places that could be tightened up though, and improved and made much clearer. We've got a few suggestions in that regard. We can submit them to the committee if that's useful, or I can go through them now. It just depends on if you'd rather. I went through other changes as well, convener, because there's a few changes we could suggest that we just think would clear up inconsistencies there, more around whether if a decision is taken forward, we think it'd be better to say will not be supported unless they contribute, rather than saying proposals, development proposals will contribute. We just think that's more a more realistic expectation of local authorities, and they'd be able to have more control over that. We can submit that exact wording change to the committee, but we think that emphasis of rather than should around most biodiversity elements to will is very important. We do firmly believe, though, and it's interesting that Claire mentioned environmental economics here. We can't manage what we don't measure, and there isn't there isn't enough emphasis here on measuring our impact on biodiversity. There's lots of great wording around protecting and enhancing and reversing biodiversity loss. But in order to do that, we need to know the impact that we've created in order to have positive effects for biodiversity. I'm basically saying that we have no idea of knowing if we have positive effects for biodiversity unless we do appropriate measurements beforehand. That the previous panel were talking about having budget associated with this, that does cost money, but the benefits are massive, and local authorities need to be resourced to do that properly. And there's also the point that Claire was raising there around knowledge and expertise. In order to implement a lot of the excellent changes here, we do need to have appropriate levels of knowledge and understanding within planning authorities.
Thanks for that, Bruce. Just to say that let's run through the questions that colleagues have, and hopefully you can bring in those policy specifics at that time. And if we haven't, then we'd welcome them in writing if we run out of time. I think we've got a lot to say on this panel. Ilse wanted to come in, and then Morag.
Thank you, Convener. I think it's a really interesting question, and the sorts of decisions that shouldn't be taken at site development, planning decisions, or even at LDP level, but probably more at a national level, because we do need to balance these issues. And as I previously mentioned, that's been done quite well in the wildland areas, where renewables and small-scale community-led development will be permitted in those areas. So I think there is a balance. We've seen, I mean, two specific examples, the housing at Steffin and the space hub at Sutherland, where they were really critical local developments for communities and the local regional economy, but they were both hugely delayed by not having really clear specific guidance around some of these issues. So I think clearer guidance, clearer national guidance for local planners to enable that balanced decision making, and as has already been referred, more skills within the local authority to support applicants on that clearer guidance will be really important to ensure that some of these critical local development projects that support rural economies are not held up for really long periods of time while some of these issues are explored. Thank you.
Thanks, Ilse. Morag.
Thank you. Just picking up on some of the points that the other people have made in this session. So I think it's important to note that we shouldn't expect the MPF4 to do everything. It is the National Planning Framework, and as people have already alluded to, it does need supporting guidance to sit alongside it, particularly with regards to biodiversity and climate. And this is something we have been working with the government and their officials on for quite some time. So particularly with regard to biodiversity, through the environmental impact assessment process, we have a very good and well-regarded method for assessing environmental impact and our do no harm model. Now we're moving into that space of positive enhancement. We don't have a metric for how we evidence that that is happening, and that is a shortcoming in our planning. So England have brought forward their net benefits for biodiversity metric. However, we've looked at it closely and it doesn't apply to Scotland because many of Scotland's biomes are very different from what you have in England, so the science does not translate across. But that is something that we would like to see come forward, because we should be able to scientifically evidence that net benefits for biodiversity are happening. And with regards to renewables, we already have a carbon calculator, albeit it's slightly out of date and it needs updating, where for every renewables development that we bring forward, we must evidence that it is a net benefit for our climate, that actually the amount of carbon it saves is greater than the embodied carbon in its construction and in its development. Excuse me, I am halfway through a sneeze and trying to give evidence at the same time and I'm stumbling. Oh, right, sorry. Let's try again and not sneeze down a microphone, which would not be a very nice thing. Anyway, so what we have been looking at with the Climate Emergency Response Group and through the Green Book process is, could such a carbon calculator be applied more generally across developments? But given the very varied nature of developments, that is not an easy question to answer. But in terms of the original question about how might you actually operationalise our ambitions around climate and biodiversity, those metrics and those tests would be a very big step forward. And just to touch on something that Elsa said that I feel is very important before we move on in the conversation around renewables and community wealth building not being mentioned in the MPF4. Again, I would emphasise that there is guidance that exists outside of the MPF4 around the development of renewables and the need for community ownership and community benefit within that. So that actually sits in separate guidance from the National Planning Framework 4, but in any development proposal, you would be expected to bring that forward in line with the good practice guidance agreed between industry and government. And the target with government at the moment is half of all new developments should have an offer of shared community ownership within them. And actually, it's sitting around about 60% of all things brought forward. So just to make it clear that while things are not in the MPF4, it doesn't mean that they haven't been taken into account.
Morag, when you say the half should have community...
Shared community ownership.
Can you say a little bit more about what that would be then?
Certainly. So the model that we had, which was established when we started doing commercial scale wind farms, particularly in Scotland, was that there was £5,000 per megawatt of installed capacity would be given in community benefit payments. Given that wind farms are getting bigger and so on, a lot of communities wanted to be able to actually invest in the wind farm itself instead of just receiving the voluntary contribution. And that's what community shared ownership is. The community buy essentially a share of the development, and then the income that comes from that, they get a share of those profits. So it is a more complicated mechanism for a community to engage in rather than community benefit, which is just a voluntary payment. But Community Energy Scotland do a lot of work around that, supporting communities to engage in those opportunities. So that's why both things exist at the moment. You would do one or the other, not generally both, but it is about giving communities the opportunity to fully benefit from developments that are happening in their community.
Thanks. And Liz?
Thank you. Just picking up on the kind of general point around that, I mean, NPF4, just to be clear, it's not saying that the climate emergency and nature crisis policies are there to restrict development that's needed. They are to be given significant weight in decision-making. So housing is a need that exists and still has to be met, and NPF4 is clear on that. And I think we need to be careful about our thought process around where new housing is allocated in terms of brownfield versus greenfield. It's not necessarily one's good, one's bad. It's much more nuanced than that. For example, in fact, MPF4, actually, there's a statement in there now, a sentence in policy 9, which is the brownfield and vacant derelict land policy, which refers to the fact that it needs to be taken into account that a lot of the brownfield sites will have urban greening, for example, so they will actually be quite biodiverse. On the flip side, a lot of greenfield sites will be much less biodiverse. I think we also need to be careful about how we plan our future housing. So we're not saying that we're restricting where that goes, because if we think about a lot of local authorities in Scotland, a lot of them don't have a lot of brownfield land left or vacant derelict land that can be delivered. And clearly, deliverability is a key strand, particularly in the housing policy of MPF4. So I think we need to be thinking about the climate and nature crisis broadly, yes, significant weight, but actually think about where we're locating our homes. So what does sustainable mean? Well, actually, if a home's closer to where you work, or if a home is closer to where your family network is for support to bring up a family, for example. So, yes, significant weights to be applied, but it certainly doesn't read to me that's to restrict development in any way. That's the development that's needed.
One of the things that I've been wondering about housing is that, you know, we've had this model where we kind of have an individual or maybe semi-detached housing, kind of, I think about models on the edge of Edinburgh or the edge of the town where I live. And I wonder if there's consideration in the housing sector that maybe we need to be having different models where we're going for, even in rural or more rural areas, terraced housing, so we're not using up so much land. It seems to me that since I've been in Parliament, there is such a challenge around what we put where in the land that we have, and there's now this kind of call for our food possibly to be grown more locally, certainly not exporting so much and growing vegetables and things like that. So it just seems to me that I wonder, you know, everything's having to give a bit, and I'm wondering if Homes for Scotland members are considering looking at different styles of housing that they might make available.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, it's already been looked at in terms of developers already look at the efficient use of land. So they do have a broad range of products, and there are sort of density policies out there already. So it's not new, and certainly to meet the needs, there's a broad range of products. So, yeah, it is something that is being looked at, and it will form part of the story going forward for new housing. But I think we need to be just careful around some of the sort of thought processes that, you know, what I'm trying to say is that on a brownfield site, it can be harder to meet some of the policies and kind of come back to some of the conflicts, particularly if you're thinking about, if you go back to local living, 20-minute neighbourhoods, and you're looking to introduce new facilities, for example, schools, it might be harder to, where's that school going to go? A sort of urban brownfield site versus greenfield that can contribute towards new schools, open spaces, retail. So I think we need to take a broader view. But yeah, to answer your question, apologies, yes, it's something that the industry's already looking at in terms of efficient use of land, and it's in the industry's interest to do that anyway.
Thanks very much for that. I'm going to, Bruce, I know you wanted to come back in, but in the interest of time, I might be saying that a lot today, this morning, I'd like to move on and see if you can tuck whatever you wanted to bring in into another response. So we're going to move on to questions from Mark Griffin, who's joining us online. And Mark, if you can ask all your questions at the same time, that would be great.
Okay, thanks, Kavina. There's been a lot of focus and attention by government and parliaments on economic growth, which is understandable given the turmoil recently. And just wanted to ask witnesses if you think there is enough emphasis on economic growth within the draft planning framework, and are you confident that that there's compatibility within the planning framework? Will that essentially enable and drive economic growth in Scotland?
Okay. Morag.
I'm happy to pick up on that question, Mark. So one of the things that we've identified in the renewable energy industry is we are a driver of economic activity, and also our provision of a secure and affordable energy source underpins the rest of the economic activity that takes place within our country. So in terms of what this MPF4 can support, if we are to stay on track to hit our net zero targets, in between now and 2030, we will need to deliver about 12 gigawatts of onshore wind. That we estimate will generate around 17,000 to 18,000 jobs across Scotland and put about 28 billion GVA into our economy. So this is very significant. At the same time, although it's not included within the MPF4, we will be doing offshore wind development. What we've seen through ScotWind, leasing round for the seabed, again represents somewhere in the region of £28 billion worth of investment coming into our country. And all of that electricity that's generated in the North Sea comes onshore. So the grid reinforcement that we need to do, again, to transport this electricity to where it is needed, is another huge source of economic activity. Between our two grid operators in Scotland, over the next 5 years, they will spend somewhere in the region of £10 billion on grid reinforcements. And that's before we get into the decarbonisation of heat and the need for storage to be added to our grid to balance out intermittent renewables. So the economic opportunities here are huge. So although that may not come through specifically in the MPF4, what the MPF4 can unlock in terms of renewables and what it can bring into our economy is very significant.
Thanks. And Liz, do you want to come in on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, the view hasn't changed greatly from the first draft of the MPF4. It does place greater weight and emphasis on the environmental sustainability of Scotland, and not necessarily on the balanced, is probably the right terminology, and the social and economic benefits that the MPF4 can bring. And mirroring Morag's comments on the renewables industry, you know, it in terms of, yes, let's talk about it, housing performs a social need, meets the social needs of Scotland, but equally economic benefits that, that come from new house building, from indirect, direct and indirect employment, has to be recognised as well. Has the balance been struck, is the question. I'm still remain to be convinced is the answer, and some of that will come back to actually how this document is implemented, and whether it can keep up pace with the need for new homes across the country. So, yeah, I think follow-up guidance will be very important, particularly around LDPs and how developments will come forward and how that will be tracked. So again, we'll come back to the metrics. But yeah, there's still a lot of work to be done around the sort of social and economic benefits that, that should come from MPF4. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And now we'll go to panel online. So I'm going to take the in the following order, Claire, Ailsa, and then Bruce.
Thank you. I guess I understand the pressure on MSPs around growth and need to establish, you know, to make sure everybody is, you know, got a good quality of life and so on. And there must be a lot of pressure on MSPs at the moment. But I also don't want to lose sight of what this document is sort of trying to achieve. And last week, 100 organisations, charities and also economists from the Movement for a Wellbeing Economy, they all signed a letter urging Nicola Sturgeon to transform the national planning, the national performance framework into a wellbeing framework in order to strengthen its power and reach. And in their letter, they said that a narrow focus on GDP and growth perpetuates the same logic that has delivered decades of poverty, inequality, and environmental degradation. And now I know that the central purpose of the planning system has, up until now, been, you know, framed around the pursuit of sustainable economic growth. And in practice, this has meant, you know, largely facilitating private sector development because governments see this as key to economic growth. And this means that development itself has become sort of more or less synonymous with the public interest. So the introduction of the wellbeing economy wording in the MPF is hopeful, if only it weren't in the same document that also seeks to promote growth and GDP. So, you know, planning priorities, you know, are still there to facilitate development and minimise constraints on market forces. It's very light touch in terms of regulation and, you know, there's still a focus on efficiency and speed of processing planning applications to satisfy what appears to us to be the number one customer, which is the applicant, not communities. But I think if this is going to be really lead us to a more equal, planet-friendly planning system, we've just got to stop believing that growth and development can be limitless. And we have to start being efficient with our land and not supporting policies that allocate overly generous amounts of land for housing and that lock us into unsustainable futures. So I think replacing our addiction to growth means, you know, developing an entirely different set of criteria that will be needed to use to assess what development is considered in the public interest. And I think we've got a real duty to the next generation, to the many young people who are terrified of the future. We've got a moral imperative to just get over our addiction to growth. You know, growth irrelevant, no planet. Thank you.
Thank you, Claire. Ailsa and then Bruce.
Thank you, Convener. Just quickly, I think the framework has made huge positive steps in terms of supporting local economic development, particularly community-led economic development, which is really important for the sustainability of local communities. So very supportive of that. I think the big issue, which Liz has already picked up on, is around housing. And Morag mentioned the numbers of jobs that we're hoping to create from the renewables developments that are coming online over the next 10 years, but we've got nowhere to house these people. We're not going to see the economic benefits of those jobs in Scotland unless we've got places to people for people to live. So I think it's really important that we go back and look at the framework and check that it's doing all it can in terms of supporting housing developments in the right areas to ensure that we maximise and optimise the benefits from ScotWind and Intog and the onshore renewables that Morag's already mentioned. That will be the barrier to economic growth, I think. Thank you.
Thanks. And Bruce.
Thanks. The panel probably expect me to come on and say that, you know, there is no economic growth on a dead planet, and that is certainly true. But we need to be looking at the economic opportunity in doing this right with regards to climate and nature. We've got a chance to create a completely green collar economy here, and people think about that often in terms of new jobs and peatland creation or forestry and woodland. Absolutely, those are massively important jobs, often occurring in rural areas in Scotland. But there are also jobs for green financiers, green engineers, ecological clerks of work, a whole new industry. And we have to be affecting that paradigm shift if we want to meet nature and climate emergency head on. So I would really encourage the committee and planners to not view this as a binary, it's nature and climate, or if we're building new housing developments, those have to be permeable to nature, they have to manage water properly, they have to be as carbon efficient as they possibly can be. It isn't just a case of housing should have a negative impact on the environment. We have to maximise the benefits of that new development, have carbon and biodiversity in setting on that site, so that we are replacing habitat if it's lost, and we are, as I say, we're making those permeable for nature. Absolutely crucial to this is the guidance documents that are going to come out around this. Things like the nature networks, we have to be using those as strategic tools to highlight where nature-based solutions can go in the landscape. The nature network can be a tool that involves local communities. And it can help plan, it can help get around some of the issues that Ailsa was highlighting around natural capital investments in the landscape. We need to involve people in those discussions and decisions, and we need to use a strategic tool like the Nature Network opportunity maps to get that right. So, yeah, I really don't think we can afford to view this as economy, or it needs to be everything balanced sustainably, but the environment completely underpins everything that we do in planning arena, the economic arena, the social arena, everything.
Thanks for that, Bruce. Mark, I think you have another question.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Thanks for those answers. I've a question that I probably direct towards Liz. You raised concerns about the MATLAR figures in the earlier draft. I think you flagged issues again on those figures and the Honda process that informs that. Are you able to outline your concerns to the committee and what changes you think still need to be made to give an effective housing land supply?
Yes, thanks, Mark. The MATLAR figures are critical. Yes, they are minimums. We understand that. And yes, we do see now that there's an expectation for LDPs to exceed their MATLAR, which is good to see. I can't see yet where that carrot or stick approach is to make sure that's done or even meet that minimum figure. The first thing I would touch on in the MATLAR figures is the way that they were calculated by local authorities across the country. It's quite an inconsistent approach. And that was for various reasons. Some had time or inclination to do more work to examine the figures. So, for example, to use the Honda as a baseline, it is dependent on secondary data, and it is dependent on previous population trends to predict the future. However, some local authorities either had the time, they were already in the process of looking at their new Honda, or had the resource to actually go out and do some primary research. So actually go out and identify beyond the baseline minimum, which is in the Honda process. And when the local authorities that did this, so you look at some of the authorities in sort of Dundee City region, some in perhaps Ayrshire, the figures came up considerably. There was also some that didn't have time or perhaps didn't have resource to undertake more work. So for me, the big issue when I look at the MATLAR figures, because they're so important to this draft, so critical to housing delivery for the next 10 years, is the approach needed to be more consistent. And actually, for me, there was a lost opportunity, because I can see now with the revised draft that there was an opportunity to change those. So you can see some authorities, because they've had a new Honda come through in the time between the first draft and this draft, they've been amended. So it would have been good if local authorities had guidance that actually you've now got more time to go out and look at your figures. So that is sort of the first concern with how these figures are coming about. And of course, they are minimums, but they are now out in the public domain. The other central issue that we have, and this has been raised at committee previously, is the Honda toolkit itself, and the fact that it drastically underestimates the actual housing in demand. It is, in terms of the need, it's based on a very restricted view of what that need is. So a household must be both overcrowded and concealed to be counted. So what it doesn't include for large swathes of our population, I'll just cite a few examples now. Perhaps a family living in a home without enough bedroom space. Perhaps single people still living at home with their parents. Older people in homes that are no longer fit to meet their needs. Perhaps two-storey housing. Perhaps they're actually looking to downsize. The property's too big, but they've nowhere to go and they want to stay in the local area. It doesn't touch upon actually this existing housing stock. So I think it isn't fit for purpose. It does set a baseline, and it is clear that local authorities can go above that baseline. But for me, the baseline is set far too long. It also uses the previous population trends to predict the future, which is a dangerous game to play, because we've had an undersupply for the last 10 years, even post-recession, you know. So those figures for those previous trends are coming out of that sort of post-2008 period. So they clearly, it's not right that they're then used to predict growth and areas for growth. So for me, one of the key points that MPF4 could still do is look to have a sort of fundamental review to the Honda toolkit. And actually, what I was going to propose is, if any members or actually the committee as a whole, Homes for Scotland are happy to facilitate a sort of workshop, seminar to discuss where we see the shortcomings and actually how do we address that. And we could pull in some experts. There's been a lot of research done on it. Homes for Scotland have got a tool that local authorities could use. So I just think, yeah, the minimums as they stand, I mean, you look at some of them, they're less than the previous 10-year completions, particularly in the West. Some of the figures are drastically low, where it's actually identified in the spatial section, you know, the growth, the population is set to decline. Well, why are we allowing it to? So we really need to look at the Honda toolkit. I understand it is up for review. And actually, when I looked at the committee report from March, from the first draft, it did say that the committee asked the Scottish Government to review the Honda at the earliest opportunity to develop a tool that is up to date and fit for all areas of Scotland. So it's just to carry on that message and offer the Home for Scotland could facilitate that as an ongoing work stream for this committee.
Thanks, Liz, for that comprehensive response. I think the committee is going to be looking at this later in 2023. I think Claire Simmons would like to come in. And if I can ask everyone to start keeping their answers a bit more succinct, that would be really helpful, because we've still got quite a few questions to get through. Claire.
Thanks. I just want to be clear that our aim is not to prevent housing development, but what we want is more emphasis on housing need and being efficient with the amount of land that we use. And I think that the approach, it has been on providing enough land to allow developers a surplus so that they can pick and choose what sites they wish to develop. And our concern is that the amount of land allocated in the MATLA is too generous and undermines the effectiveness of the plan and more progressive policies on climate and housing, climate and biodiversity. You know, I think one of the key things, and we can send you some more written evidence on this, but I think the high MATLA figures means that local authorities have to allocate more land for housing than is really needed. There's a lot of inbuilt flexibility. You know, it's already got 20 to 30, 35% inbuilt flexibility. You know, we think that a realistic MATLA could be something more like 1,117 units, 117,000 units, not the 202. You know, there's been a huge uplift of about 78%. And this, you know, comes from a mixture of things, but it's about the fact that, you know, they're sort of ignoring the projected population falls, but there's always uplifts in and quite ambitious projections on population increases that don't necessarily take into account the latest census figures. So we were wondering, you know, is the map going to be reassessed according to the latest census figures that might take into account things like Brexit and the cost of living and so on. So we would ask that, you know, new population data from the latest census will be adopted into the MATLA figures. And I'll send more information about this to the committee, because I understand that we, you know, represent quite a different view, but we strongly feel that the MATLA is overly generous.
Thank you, Claire. Thank you. I'm now going to move on to questions from Marie McNair.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'm keen to continue with the same line of questions that I used in the previous panel. I'd like to hear from Liz first and then anyone else who would like to come in after that. Liz, are you satisfied that the terms of such as community wealth, building and 20-minute neighbourhoods are sufficiently well-defined and understood to provide a robust basis for planning decision-making? You touched slightly on the 20-minute neighbourhood earlier, but you might want to expand further.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, I think there has been improvements in the draft for both of them. I mean, community wealth building is something, you know, that Homes for Scotland have been discussing with local authorities specifically, because we can see it coming. You know, we saw it in the first draft. And I suppose what we've been doing meantime is trying to get our own heads around what does it mean. Mm-hmm. And in fairness, I think local authorities are probably doing that as well. And as Jim touched on earlier, you know, North Ayrshire were the first to actually implement a strategy. So, in short, I mean, the new revised MPF4 is much more detailed as to what it actually means. I think there was a bit of a confusion over community benefits versus community wealth building. They're two different things. So community wealth building seems to be more around sort of local supply chains, local employment, keeping wealth locally. So yes, I think our understanding has improved as an industry, but we've still got a bit to go. And I think local authorities do as well, just to exactly what that will mean. And what is expected of us. So when we submit an application that has to take cognizance of community wealth building, what is the local authority going to be looking for? And in fairness, I'm not sure the guidance is quite there yet as to, you know, what is that exactly? It's quite a new policy movement, but it's much better in the new draft, but there's still more learning to be done around it. Just touching quickly on local living, 20-minute neighbourhoods, I am happy that the new policy does seem to provide more flexibility, particularly around recognising the difference in context. So, as again, it was touched on in the previous session that, you know, 20 minutes, let's not get too tied up on the number. That means different things to different places, rural, suburban, urban. So I think there's a bit more flexibility there, and that actually the proof will be in the pudding as to how it's implemented. And that might be something that we keep an eye on going forward in terms of a metric. But it's sustainable planning, which isn't a new concept. We've just given it a slightly different name.
Thank you. Anyone else that wants to come in on that?
So Elsa wants to come in, and then Claire briefly, and then see who else wants to come in. Elsa.
Thank you, Convener. Very quickly, I think community benefits is a term that's well understood, but community wealth building probably less so. And the framework would benefit from a clearer articulation of what that is. Liz has just outlined some of those elements about keeping wealth locally through jobs, supply chains, ownership, local ownership of assets, etc. And that's particularly for the private sector and developers who I think are catching up with a policy that is quite well embedded now within national and local government. Thank you.
Claire?
Yes, sorry. I just wanted to mention about the policy 16B on the requirement for a statement of community benefit. At the moment, there's no requirement for community input in that, and it's sort of interesting how you know the house builders are equipped to how well they're going to be equipped to know what is best for each community in Scotland. So whether there's any disbenefit for balance. So I just think this is more stuff to be done, more statements to be written, and to be honest, it just allows a bit more opportunity for more propaganda on behalf of the developer, if you ask me. So I'd rather, that there was significant community input into these statements.
Thanks, Claire. Morag, did you want to come in?
Sure, I can just come in briefly on that one. That we have, myself, on behalf of Scottish Renewables, have been sitting on the group that are looking at the Community Wealth Building Bill and how that happens, and looking about clarifying these definitions. And I would agree with Liz that we've certainly come a long way in the MPF4 document about making it clearer what these need. But I would go back to my earlier point that we can't expect the MPF4 to do anything, and I would expect it to be fully supported by guidance that's coming through elsewhere. So it is absolutely unequivocal what it means. And we have been putting forward the example from onshore wind, where we have an obligation to consult with communities as part of our development process, and looking at what can be learned from that to feed into that community wealth building process.
Just a further question. There's numerous references to the infrastructure first approach in the revised NPF4, and really wanted to ask, has it been delivered in practice? If not, what needs to change? And I'm keen to hear from others on their view on this, and previous witnesses have mentioned about the resource implications. Sorry, I'll pop it back to yourself just for the...
That's okay. I think, you know, I would reiterate what we said previously, is it's a laudable policy. Yes, infrastructure first, on paper, that's the way it should be done. I suppose the concern is still that when I read the new document and you read the new policy, it's not changed much. I then look at the delivery programme, and I'm not seeing that. As we mentioned, the capital investment plan, I'm not seeing the guidance yet on regional spatial strategies, because your infrastructure does span local authorities. And the concern is that it's not in there to be a blocker to development, but if it's not planned right, then it could be. So I think the intent of the policy is a good one, but there needs to be more work done, particularly in the development programme, as to how it all comes together, including statutory bodies. So how do local authorities work with statutory bodies? How do we, particularly for housing, if there is that pipeline, so we can see ahead for the next 10, 15 years, then how is that then communicated to other bodies to make sure that infrastructure can come through on time and at pace? So the policy is a good one, but there needs to be a lot more behind it to make it happen, to get it delivered.
Thank you. Thanks. Anyone else?
Bruce wanted to come in online.
Thanks. I'll just keep it very, very brief. We were actually slightly confused about the wording here. It's policy 18 on infrastructure first, and sets out the test of planning obligations that currently sit within a circular. But then the circular that's quoted is a shortened version. It's actually slightly misquoted. And we're therefore a little bit confused about which has more precedence here, the circular or the MPF4. So I think that's just a wording that needs tightened up slightly within the document.
Thank you for those comments. Take them on board. Back to yourself.
Morag, did you want to come in on this? Or
My points were very similar to Liz's.
Okay.
So.
Great, thanks. Is there anyone else online? No. Okay, great. Thanks, Marie. I'm now going to move on to a question from Annie Wells, who's joining us online.
Good morning, Convener. Again, good morning, panel.
It's a very similar question to ask the last panel. Every local place plan will have to have regard to NPF4. And looking at the draft document, how confident are you that community bodies will be able to do so? And as we heard from the last panel, I'd asked them what support might be required to assist communities, and they said that definitely additional resource would be a requirement, with plans taking up to £10,000 per plan. And I just wondered for some sort of a feedback or an agreement or acknowledgement or anything different, if you would like to answer any of those questions.
OK, we've got Claire, Ailsa and Bruce online. They're quick on the buzzer there. Claire.
Thanks, Annie. Great to have the local place plans in place, but I guess we're rather more concerned about whether local development plans will be able to have regard for the local place plans, to be honest. Right. But one of our concerns around the LPPs is that if local development plans allocate large tracts of land to, say, housing, and house builders are busy buying up land and negotiating options on land with local landowners, we're wondering what land is actually going to be left for community ambitions. And with a lack of information on options, you know, how are local communities supposed to know what land is already earmarked for housing? And so, you know, really support the idea of a register for the options. You know, it's not clear how much list house builders own, but we haven't done the calculations. But if in England is there anything to go by, mm-hmm. then most of the land around major cities and towns is already owned or held under option. And we've got anecdotal evidence from farmers in Scottish urban edge semi-rural locations that most of them have optioned their land already. So, you know, how are communities supposed to deliver their own ambitions if they don't know what that land is being, you know, already proposed for? So I think that's, a big point.
Thanks, Claire. Ailsa.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, I think local place plans are a great opportunity for local people to get much more engaged with the planning process in a way that they perhaps don't with local development plans. So they do need resourcing. They are intensive in terms of both planning officer time, which we're obviously thinking about here, but they're also extremely resourceful in local volunteer time. And we shouldn't ignore that when we're thinking about the development of local place plans and how we help resource that. There have been occasions where there's not been that many local place plans yet, but there have been occasions where they've been ignored in planning decisions. So we need to ensure that those local place plans are given their due weight in the new local development plans. And of course, they can also be aligned to wider community plans in terms of developments that communities want to see brought forward. So they're a really useful part of the process, but they need to be strengthened both in terms of resourcing and also the value they're giving in the planning application process. Thank you, convener.
Thanks, Ailsa. Bruce?
Yeah, my points are very similar to Claire and Ailsa's. I'd maybe just add that the kind of long-awaited guidance around nature networks will also be very helpful in this process as well. It helps inform local authorities local groups about what nature can happen where within their doorsteps, gives them a tool to get involved in the climate and nature emergency, which can often feel quite a removed conversation for communities, and that applies equally to urban and rural as well. So yeah, just like to agree with those points that were made previously and add that in.
Thanks, Bruce. Liz, do you want to come in?
Yeah, local place plans, you know, it's a big opportunity for communities to proactively plan, you know, the settlements, and actually, you know, to reach out to developers who may have an allocation, a local plan to speak on a proactive basis about what that new development can bring actually to an area. So I think, though, is what we need to be careful of is that they are reflective of that community as a whole. So how do we reach out to the people that currently maybe don't feel engaged in the planning system or actually know there's an opportunity to engage, and then make sure that, again, across settlements in towns and villages, that there'll be some communities more geared up for this than others. So how do we approach that on a consistent and fair basis? But I see there being an opportunity. I think as a development industry, very happy to engage with these. And I see them as a sort of a good proactive tool for communities to use.
Thanks very much. And Morag?
Most of my points would have reiterated what has already been said. Okay. So in the interest of time, I'll leave it there.
Thanks very much. Okay.
Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Annie. Okay, we're going to move on to questions from Paul McLennan.
You know, and good morning, panel. A couple of things, I think, for me. One was around about the delivery programme. Just I wondered if you had any views on that, obviously, which accompanies the NPF4. And the second part of the question was really talking about, and I think we kind of touched on it, some committee members have talked about it as well, is around about one of the key things the committee were keen to look at was in terms of monitoring the implementation and looking at indicators going ahead to make sure that it was a live document. So I'm just wondering, on the delivery programme and on the indicators, what you'd like to see. And I'll probably come to yourself, Liz, then Morag, then kind of open it up to the panel behind that. But Liz, yourself, first of all.
Thanks, Paul. I think the delivery plan at the moment, I mean, it is the first iteration we've seen of it. There wasn't a delivery plan with the original draft. For me, it still lacks quite a bit of detail on how the financial and practical interventions to deliver on brownfield and vacant derelict land, that's still missing. It's also, you know, it details at the back all of the guidance documents that still need to come, still need to be published to back up some of the policies. So, for example, so the LDP regs and guidance, which will be critical to understanding how the housing pipeline will work, housing land audit guidance, which again will be critical in determining sort of that deliverable 10 plus pipeline. Planning and climate change guidance is still to come, which again, you know, significantly weigh on the climate emergency. So for me, it's a start, but it very much needs to be tracked. And actually, coming on to your second question about metrics, that was my first point, is that I think in the short term, we should be looking to the delivery programme and saying, right, what documents are still to come to actually make sure that MPF4 is delivered and implemented with the policy intent. And so it is to be reviewed in the first 6 months and then annually thereafter. So I think that needs to be the basis, really, for metrics. In terms of other metrics, I mean, quite broadly speaking, I mean, in the short term, we absolutely need to keep an eye on planning application, planning decisions. We've not touched on it yet in this session, but there is a lack of transitional guidance that's come with MPF4. And I think there was a sort of reasonable expectation from ourselves, our own industry, that would come alongside the document, particularly with the amount of applications already in the system awaiting determination. So with local authorities and with the DPAA. So in the short term, we absolutely need to track decision times. And in the longer term, it needs to track housing delivery, housing numbers, and in time matters will become critical. And actually, it should be tracking how are the new LDPs progressing? Because MPF4 is here now, adopted, let's say, early next year, the new LDPs are following on to that, and actually the first ones won't be adopted till 2027. So it's now absolutely critical that whilst the system has been paused for quite a long time, these LDPs are now coming forward. But as we know, that is going to cause some resource constraints, particularly within the reporters unit, as has already been mentioned. So I think there's a few thoughts. I probably have more, but I think just in terms of, you know, picking up one of the positive things about the delivery programme, you know, the planning infrastructure and place advisory group that's in place, and you know, we would very much wish to be involved with that. And we also noted there was an applicant stakeholder group to be put in place, and again, Homes for Scotland would very much like to be involved with that. So for me, it's a start, the delivery programme, but it needs to have a focus now to make sure it's implemented.
I think the first, you mentioned the transitional arrangements, and I think that was raised in the first panel. I think that's going to be coming through and through, and the evidence we're taking, I think that's something obviously we need to look at as a committee. Morag, from your point of view, just to say the same question again.
I would completely agree with Liz that the delivery plan is a good start. I can understand that the MPF4 has changed significantly between drafts, and now the delivery plan has to do a bit of running to catch up. It is heading in the right direction, but it's not as developed as we'd want to see. And again, I'd reiterate Liz's point about speed of implementation here. In terms of the monitoring and what to be monitored going forward, the Climate Change Committee obviously provides independent advice to the Scottish Government and its administrations across the UK on what is needed to meet net zero. So as a framework that is supposed to enable the meeting of net zero, we would definitely want to see the MPF4 monitored against that. And again, we expect to see biodiversity targets coming through the Parliament in the near future and it to be measured against that. A couple of things to pick up on that have come up. One's come up in conversation already, but one has not, that would be a very key place for us from a renewables perspective to want to see monitored. The first one is around wildland. As it's been alluded to, there has been a change of policy around that. And just to be clear what that means in practice, it does say that you can now develop commercial wind farms and renewables in wild land. However, there's some big caveats to that. So 49% of wild land sits within national parks or national scenic areas, so could never be developed for renewables. Once you include everything that has a designation on it, for example, a site of special scientific interest or something like that, or that's a loch or a river, obviously not suitable for renewables, that once you take all of that out, you're only left with about a third of the wild land in Scotland. And then you have to get into, well, is the wind regime sufficient? Is there a grid connection? And so on and so on. So actually the amount becomes smaller and smaller. So it's not a case that simply now all wild land can be considered as a site. It simply says around a third of it is now a possibility that could be explored. But we do need to make sure that that is actually coming through in policy. And there's one other thing that is actually a deep concern of ours around how the MPF4 has been written that will need to be monitored very closely, because we have identified a key conflict in the policies. So in policy 11, it identifies very clearly the need for grid enforcements to our electricity grid to be able to meet net zero. And I should make it clear to the committee, how grid works is a very unique thing in planning. In Scotland, there are two grid operators. There's SSE networks in the north and there's Scottish Power energy networks in the south. They are natural monopolies, so they are regulated very closely by Ofgem, and what they can and cannot build is regulated very closely. They have to operate under two parameters. One, they must provide connections to people to the grid, but it must be at lowest cost to consumer and it must maintain the stability and the integrity of our electricity system. There is what's called the pathway to 2030, which is where they have done a very clear plan of what grid connections are going to be needed as we go forward towards 2030. And SSEN transmission networks have highlighted that the majority of ancient woodland in Scotland sits within their area. And they have done a very detailed map of the grid reinforcements that they are going to need to do. And they cannot find a way where they can do it without it impinging in some places on ancient woodland. So currently we have the policy in MPF4, policy 6, clause B, development proposals will not be supported where they will, part 1, result in any loss of ancient woodlands, veteran trees or adverse impacts on their ecological condition. Now we absolutely support that policy, but we are going to hit up against this conflict. And I should make it very clear that as an organisation, SSEN Transmission Networks have a biodiversity net gain strategy. As an organisation, they have committed that every project they do will result in a gain for biodiversity. So an example of where this kind of conflict has come up in the past is in Argyll. Sorry, I need to look up the specific name of the grid reinforcement because there are many. It was the grid reinforcement that they did around the West Coast, where they worked with the Argyll Coast and Countryside Trust. And what they were looking at was a grid reinforcement that ran from Inverary to Crossaig that impacted on Scotland's Atlantic rainforest, which is a very precious resource. They couldn't not have an impact there. So what they did is that they paid for a woodland officer, they paid for outdoor learning opportunities, they paid for the use of local supply chain, health and wellbeing improvements, and they did mitigation planting as well. So the area of woodland was actually expanded beyond the impact that they would have had. This is something we are going to have to monitor very closely because, as you say, as an industry, we are absolutely committed to that biodiversity target. And we are absolutely committed to the preservation of ancient woodland. but enable people to actually be able to access electricity. At some points, these grid reinforcements are going to come in contact with that. So this is something we would want the committee to pay very close attention to, is if we have accidentally created an undermining of one policy by the other. So I will stop there.
Yeah, thanks, Morgan. That was something I was going to raise, so thank you for bringing that
thanks.
Up. I'm conscious...
Thanks. So we are we're discussing delivery plans and monitoring, but we kind of went into very specifically the ancient woodland bit. So I think Bruce has indicated that he wanted to come in anyway. So Bruce, I'll bring you in now so you could speak to that point, but also pick up Paul's questions around the delivery plan and the monitoring.
Okay, thanks. I'm frantically writing down questions to address here, so I'll try and just address slightly a lot more I said there. I mean, yeah, we agree there is a slight concern there over the wording and what takes precedence. I mean, basically, biodiversity net gain can't really apply in these situations because it is completely irreplaceable habitat. Nature isn't fungible. You can't necessarily just take one bit of nature and replace it elsewhere. So we do need to think about that. And it comes back to my point around metrics as well. We need to make sure that we have accurate metrics to work out that if we have a situation where it is completely unavoidable, that we are actually replacing with significant net gain. And that is the only thing that would take us to the spirit of the MPF4 and its commitment to addressing nature and climate crisis. Hopefully that's addresses that point. Within the delivery plans itself, there's the introduction of the new Planning Infrastructure and Place Advisory Group. Just really, really important that we have appropriate levels of environmental expertise on that group. It can be it can be very easy to overlook these things within expert groups. And it kind of speaks a little bit to the point Mark was talking about economic benefits. We are going to have to upskill people with new skills to tackle the this kind of nature and climate crisis. So it's important that group has appropriate expertise on it. There's a really important omission that we've spotted as well here, that page 13 of the delivery plan, it references kind of documents or key plans and strategies to cross-reference with. There's no reference in there that we can see whatsoever of the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy, the refresh that's happening at the moment, or the environment strategy that's current. And I think that's really important that that's included to make sure that we're paying proper regard to an activity that can have tremendous impact on on biodiversity and the environment. There was also one of my colleagues spotted an omission for historic environment within there as well. So I think that documentation in that regard has to be included there. I think that's probably most of the points that we want to make with regard to that. So yeah, sorry, I'm just trying to make sure I've gone through. There was a point that the Nature Network's guidance isn't included in the development plan there either. We think that's very important as well. I think that was all the points that were raised there, Paul, unless there's anything else you had.
Thanks, Bruce.
Just before we go to Claire Simmons also, I was going to ask a question after Paul, but Morag already kind of brought it in, which is about wildland. Bruce, did you want to, with John Muir Trust got in touch with the committee with concerns about Policy 4, that it doesn't offer protection. So Morag has been able to speak to that. I'd like to hear from Scottish Environment.
Right, Thanks for giving me the opportunity on that one, because I was hoping to come in on that. It's quite ambiguous, this specific part of Policy 4. We think it creates a bit of legal uncertainty. Now, John Muir Trust has provided really good a briefing document to the committee about this, but we think it presents a bit of a false test as worded. And it needs to be, it's conditional on whether it can support meeting renewable energy targets. We'd assume that all renewable energy development would in some way support renewable energy targets. And we also think that that's potentially quite a moving target, and it fails to anticipate a time when it will actually be reached. Specific wording suggestions have been supplied by John Muir Trust in there, but that's the main points they were making with that briefing.
Thanks very much for that. So we'll go back to, I think Claire was going to come in next on Paul's questions on the development plan and monitoring.
Sorry, Claire, just before you give that, just coming back to the point you obviously made about the wellbeing economy, I've got a specific interest in that as well, being convener of the cross-party group. So I was really keen just if you could expand a little bit more on that, because obviously there's a national performance framework that's been reviewed at the moment, and also there's a wellbeing economy monitor framework being delivered as well. So just to try and take that your comments to that context as well, and where you kind of see NPF4 fitting in with the other two reviews that are kind of going on just now, in terms of the wellbeing economy.
I guess it's in terms of the point was really in it that you can't have GDP at the same time as a wellbeing economy, I think, and you know, just really strengthen those national performance framework metrics and the ways you measure that to align more closely with the wellbeing economy and not to put so much emphasis on growth. I think that's essentially it in a nutshell.
And obviously then the broader issues talking about obviously the delivery plan and indicators that you would like to see.
Yeah, I'll have to follow up that, but I guess some of the indicators are a bit tricky in terms of climate, because some of them are about reductions, aren't they? Reductions in carbon, and you know, how do you monitor loss of biodiversity and so on? But the point I want to make about this, which is about monitoring, is really about having a planned system, because it's so critical, I think, to communities who don't have a right of appeal and who are asked to do their own local place plans, to get involved in the local development plan, that these local development plans are adhered to. And the Planning Act did come up with some the requirement for a statement of conformity to be written, which means that planning officers are required to state whether or not the application is in keeping with the local development plan. And I think in terms of ensuring we have a plan-led system, monitoring these is really crucial. We've just done a bit of work with the new planning law clinic in Robert Gordon University, and doing some research that's supported by Neil Collar, who's one of Scotland's leading planning lawyers. And the preliminary look at that does suggest that these conformity statements are extremely variable. There's lacking guidance on them, and they're not currently a very adequate tool in terms of measuring whether or not we are conforming with the local development plan. So I think that's really important. Because the initial results seem that, you know, material considerations rather than the development plan is what's forming the planning decisions. And the other thing was around planning portals and the technology on how we might improve them, because that came out of the research very, very strongly, the difficulty that the students had in accessing and navigating these planning portals that were quite clunky, some of them. And finally, in terms of testing, I think you know, the test of this plan and whether it's working, you know, will be on what developments go ahead, and, you know, are people looking at what kind of developments, you know, the outcomes. I mean, it's about focusing the monitoring on outcomes. And, you know, revisiting the sites. I mean, are they delivering what they are supposed to deliver? You know, what impacts are they having? And, you know, decisions like the Kilmacom decision at the moment that's gone to appeal, where the development is contrary to the local development plan. There's a surplus of housing. It's going to impact on nature quite significantly there. What decision is going to be made on that when it's been, you know, notice of intention to approve this development? Is that in keeping? I mean, that's the test in my opinion as to whether or not this plan is actually working.
Okay, thanks, Claire. I think that's all for me.
Thanks very much for that. And I just want to note that we have gone over time, but I think it's really important that we have this space to get all these views out. So we have our final committee member with a few questions. Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. Thanks for joining us. My questions follow on really from Paul McLennan's then, because it's quite clear from what we've heard, the devil's going to be in the detail with regards to the guidance and transitional guidance, I think, especially. So I just wondered, in terms of your view on MPF4 and transitioning the planning system as it stands now and how it potentially will stand, and current planning applications in the system and what that looks like, and specifically maybe with regards to the housing crisis. I think that's a missed opportunity not to have that on the face of this, but just wondered in terms of where you think that could be lost in translation potentially between now and MPF4 coming in. I don't know who wants to start on that.
Yeah, I mean, as I said, the number one concern at the moment in the short term is the fact there is no transitional guidance that we've seen so far and that we're aware of being issued alongside MPF4. I mean, it's a legitimate expectation that would have been done, because we see it when other consenting regulations change, for example, building warrants. There's no line in the sand. So, you know, at the moment, when I say no line in the sand, anything that's in the system right now, be that with local authorities in terms of planning applications awaiting a decision, or with the reporters unit, when this is adopted as it stands, will need to be reassessed against MPF4. Now, when these were submitted in good faith, and a lot of time, effort, resource has been put into these by the applicant and local authorities and reporters unit, MPF4 wasn't, you know, some of them might have actually come even before the draft, because, you know, applications aren't quick to come through the system. So it's a big concern from our side as to what that is going to do in terms of decision time, certainty. And there, for me, there needs to be that line where if something's in the system already, then it's determined through the current system. So that's a short-term concern, which is a significant one that needs to be addressed, I think, by the committee initially. And actually, in the longer term, I'm not seeing much in terms of transitional guidance for the new LDPs as they start to come through the system, because we're going to have a scenario where we've got an MPF4 getting adopted now, and it's going to be 2027 before we're seeing the new adopted LDPs that will fall into line with this new document. So there needs to be guidance there to make sure that these applications that are coming through are keeping up pace. And I don't think, you know, from what I hear from others, we're not alone in terms of the public, private sector. The public sector equally are calling for this guidance. So, yeah, it's one of the main disappointments that we've not seen this guidance coming forward.
Does anyone else want to comment on that point?
This one, this is something that we have looked into with our legal members, and our understanding is that as soon as the MPF4 is in place, the decision should be based on whatever is the framework at the time that the decision is taken. But I reiterate what Liz has said, that actually, if there is a application in train that has been structured on the previous guidance, actually doing that restructuring could be quite a burdensome thing on both sides, for the applicant and for the authority who's doing the decision making. The quicker we get MPF4 in place, however, the general opinion of our members is the quicker we make that transition and the less of a problem that becomes. Our nightmare scenario is that we end up in this sort of twilight zone between documentation where nobody's quite sure which one we're working with, and that ambiguity and uncertainty is likely to cause far more problems than a rapid transition from one to the other.
Thanks.
And Bruce, you want to come in?
Yeah, so very quickly, as well as the need for new guidance, I've already said a lot of times that we really need to get that nature network guidance out there to help local authorities strategically plan where green and blue infrastructure is going to go and all the nature-based solutions that can provide. We've just seen extensive flooding across the country. If we're to fight that with nature-based solutions, we need to plan that on the landscape. And without that guidance in place, I don't think local authorities are going to be able to do it very easily. And the other point is that some of the existing guidance that's there already is not coherent with climate and nature. So we, as well as the new guidance, we need to also, I'm sorry to say, adding workload, some of the old guidance is just not appropriate in the context that we find ourselves in the climate and nature emergency.
Thank you. And just finally, I wanted to ask, and maybe sound like a broken record on this, but as an Edinburgh MSP, I am really concerned about the emphasis just on brownfield development, which is, you know, unlikely to be forthcoming here in the capital. There are businesses, very viable businesses, currently on these sites, and they have had no communication or no real conversation over what the future with MPF4 looks like for them. So I just wondered, in terms of MPF4, what issues do you think there are needing still to be addressed around that pipeline of land coming forward for all the commitments which are in this plan to actually be achieved, especially around the housing crisis?
Thanks. I mean, I think what we asked for is in the first draft was a fix to where our pipeline is under-delivering. Because if it's under-delivering, something has to happen. So at the moment, there is still no mechanism to fix an under-delivering pipeline, except to bring in longer-term sites and sites that are beyond the 10 years in LDPs. But generally speaking, they are in that bracket for a reason. So what if they can't come forward and plug that gap? At the moment, I say, without the guidance, the LDP guidance, it's not clear if there is a fix. I really hope there is a fix, and we want to engage with Scottish Government further on that to discuss how that might be done. But it's a big concern that if we're under-delivering, so for example, a plan review, what would trigger that? And could that just be a sort of housing, you know, section of the review? The other part is, so we're talking about under-delivering, big concerns there if that's happening, if and when. It's also not clear if there's an over-delivering pipeline, then there is the ability that further land can come in. But it's quite clear in policy 9, as it now is, the brownfield and vacant derelict land policy, that cannot be greenfield. But as I said before, what if there simply isn't any other brownfield, vacant derelict land sites there to come in? Then what do you do? So there's scenarios that haven't been worked through. So as it stands, I can't legitimately say that I can, you know, say that policy 16 will deliver the homes that we need. Equally, we still don't have a clear definition of what a deliverable site is. Now, MPF4 is very clear, and we're supportive of this, that sites must be deliverable. And as a clear mandate that where sites aren't deliverable, they are deallocated. So sitting behind that, we need a very, very clear definition of what that is. What does deliverable mean? And also, there's now a short, medium, long-term pipeline of sites in a post-10-year. Again, we've not got the definitions yet as to what that is. So what sites should be in short? What do they need to have in terms of planning consents, infrastructure? So it's critical that the guidance comes forward to explain how this is going to work. Or the danger is you get to year 5, 6, 7 of an LDP, it's not delivering, where's the fix? And at the moment, it's not clear what that fix is. And you could almost say that, are we premature with MPF4 looking at policy 16 without the guidance alongside it? I think that's a fair statement to make. So again, with alongside the transition, lack of transitional stuff, this is up there with one of our key concerns. And we really were hoping to see more of a solution coming forward. So that will be critical, I think, is again, go back to that delivery programme. It's clear that the LDP regs and guidance are still to come, but we've not seen them. You know, we've seen a draft. We've not seen the guidance that sits behind it. So we're not clear how this will actually work in practice. And just touching on your brownfield, greenfield point, Miles, or brownfield sites in Edinburgh, you know, we can allocate brownfield, but I mean, if they're not deliverable, if they put current uses on them, then we shouldn't be allocating them because they're not going to come forward. And actually, we shouldn't always assume that that's the most sustainable way to plan our settlements, because actually what we're doing in the Edinburgh example is moving a lot of existing businesses away from the city. And I'm not clear how that can be judged as sustainable for anybody. So again, it's much more nuanced than in sort of brownfield good, greenfield bad, but big concerns there, and it's something that I would be keen to continue dialogue with the committee on.
Does anyone else want to come in?
Coming on that one. I'm going to take a slightly more philosophical view of this one, and I think this is indicative of what was going on behind MPF4, of that fundamental mind shift we need to make for a net zero world. And just thinking about the words that we use in terms of greenfield, brownfield, there's often the subconscious assumption that any kind of development is inherently bad, that you turn a greenfield site into a greyfield site where the biodiversity is gone and it's less desirable and less attractive and so on. And I think that's the mind shift that we need to make here, that development is inherently neutral. And what the MPF4 should be doing is it should be pushing developers to prove that what they will create will be better than what was there before, that it will be positive for communities, it will be positive for our climate, it will be positive for biodiversity. And for me, that's more of the approach that we should be taking. And certainly all the things that Liz has said are contributors to that. It's a very tired joke in our planning system that we have a tendency to name things after what we destroyed to create it. So Orchard Road and Meadow Bray. And we need to change that. So, you know, after the development, as there will be on our site, there will be a restored peat bog that is flourishing with more biodiversity than there was when we started. And that philosophy should be carried across all development.
Thank you. Thanks, Karina. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks for that. So that comes to the end of our questions on this panel. And I just say thank you for being with us this morning, sharing your views. It's been a really important conversation. And I think it needed that little bit of extra time to really draw them all out. Thanks for that. So I now suspend the meeting for 5 minutes to allow a change for witnesses. We now begin our final panel of witnesses on the National Planning Framework. And on panel three, we're joined by Dr. Caroline Brown, who's the Assistant Professor of Environmental Planning and Healthy Environments at the Urban Institute, Harriet Watt University. Welcome. And Professor Cliff Haig, who's a Chartered Town Planner and Chair at the Coburn Association. So I welcome you warmly. It's been a long morning, but I think it's such an important conversation that we're having. I'd like to begin with the same questions that I asked previous panels. Just would love to hear briefly if you could outline your views on key changes that have been made in the revised National Planning Framework. And maybe Caroline, you're smiling at me, so I'll choose you first.
Thank you so much, Convener. Thank you for inviting me back. I think, as others have commented, the revision to NPF 4 has brought some greater clarity and consistency in language, which is very welcome. And I think the high-level principles about the climate emergency and the nature emergency also emerge much more clearly in this version, in this revision. So I think there's a lot to be very positive about. The clarity of language, consistency is very helpful. And I think another thing that I really valued and noticed was embedding of equalities and diversity also within some of the policies. So talking about the need to plan and design for diverse needs within cycle active travel, for example. So I think that's all fantastic. There's a couple of misses for me that I wanted to draw your attention to. One is about the first spatial principle in the very beginning of the document in part one, the just transition, which, unlike the other five principles, does not seem to be explicitly very spatial. So, and I don't think NPF 4 articulates the way in which that just transition principle should be translated into a spatial policy. So what does that mean? It says things a little bit about process, but not very much about the spatial distribution. So that was my first miss. And my second miss was on health. And there's a policy called health and safety. I forget exactly which number, about 23, very good. I was going to say 22. At 23, and that's mostly about risk and harm minimisation, which is absolutely important. But I think the title of that policy and some of the language within it could be expanded, and it crosses with the six principles of good places, because number one in those six principles at the end is about healthy places. So I think health could be expanded to be much more about enabling well-being, the salutogenic model of the environment and how it supports health, as well as the risk reduction pathogenic model, minimising air pollution and so on. So that was my second kind of miss that I think the draft didn't quite articulate. I'll stop there. I think we'll come back to some of the other things.
Thanks very much. And I think I've just got a new word, salutogenic.
Salutogenic.
I think I can imagine what that means. Cliff.
Yeah, thank you. Convener, and thank you, panel, for inviting me. I really do welcome the NPF 4 and its ambition. I welcome, congratulate the team who's produced it and the politicians who supported it. And that's because it puts the climate emergency and the biodiversity emergency clearly as the overarching concerns. Having said that, and given those congratulations, I think we also need to recognise that there really isn't much choice in terms of that. Only really now vested interests and ideologues will not recognise that these are actually more significant issues than the planning system has previously treated them. And I'm very conscious that there's actually quite a lot of international interest in NPF 4, precisely because, again, other places, other countries are grappling with the same sort of issues and how you actually use the planning system to deliver on these global priorities. So I think there's a lot of good stuff. That said, I think there's still a risk that we'll fall short of the aspirations, and in a sense, this is the easy bit to write the the overarching strategy and to strike the high notes. And as people have been saying during the morning, you know, there's a lot more work that will be needed in terms of spelling out the detail, how we actually deliver. In terms of the details and just some of the things which could still be tweaked in the policies, and it's perhaps echoing some of the things that Caroline was saying. I mean, embedding gender as an issue, I think in the policy on play, which is number 21, it still needs to be recognised that the needs of girls, older girls, are not really recognised in there. And basically, I may seem as an odd guy to be talking about the needs of older girls, but my understanding is they largely like to hang out in places with their mates, basically. And so that puts an emphasis on safe public spaces as a really key factor. Housing, I think the debate still is dominated by the housing land issues. In a week where we've seen issues with the quality of social rented housing, in a tragic case down in England, I think we need to see social housing as essential national infrastructure. And this also feeds into the economic side of things, because it's crucial that there's available housing for care workers, for NHS people, whole range of key workers whose needs are not well addressed by the current debates about affordability. The really obvious thing, if you take affordability based upon average incomes, mean incomes, it really misses the point, because you should really be looking at the modal income, because very high incomes distort what the average is, right? So you're actually factoring in misleading information into that definition. Now, I know there's a working group on this, but that's the kind of thing we need to look at, and the quality of existing housing. I'll be very quick with just two or three others. Policy 20C protects regional and country parks from development incompatible with uses, habitats and character. I think that should also apply to urban parks. Urban parks are really, really important in terms of the health and well-being agenda. They're important in livability. And it's just as important to protect those spaces from development that's incompatible as it is with the national parks. Health and safety, Caroline mentioned policy 23. Again, I think it needs to give more emphasis on conserving existing urban green spaces. There should be a clear presumption against loss of green space on health and well-being grounds. And finally, and then I'll hand back to for the questions, community well-being discussion in the previous session. Some interesting data just came out yesterday, I think, from who owns Urban Scotland, showing that most of our retail centres are actually owned by offshore companies. So that's the exact opposite of community wealth building. It's community wealth extraction. So I think that in terms of 26E, business and industry, and 27A, town centres, there should be a requirement to demonstrate a contribution to community wealth building, to embed it through the system. I'll shut up there and take questions.
Thank you very much for those answers. And please don't shut up, because you know you're bringing in new. We're hearing new things from you this morning, which I think is really important. And Cliff, you already began to touch on climate and nature crisis. And I asked the question in the previous panels, and I think it's maybe more of a kind of planning question. I think it phased a few folks the last panel, but in practical terms. What does the requirement for decision makers to give significant weight to the global climate and nature crises mean for development management and development planning across Scotland?
I think I just broadly endorse what Planning Democracy was saying earlier this morning, that there needs to be clarity. The planners need to feel that when it goes to appeal, that the reporters and government decision makers have got their back on these sort of issues, because these issues will be contested. There's no doubt about it. I mean, everybody's in favour in general terms of saving the planet. It's just, don't do it to me, OK? So that there will be times where it comes to crunch at appeal. There's a concern, I think, from practising planners about getting into appeal situations, which are very resource demanding. And it must be seen that there is real support for these as priority issues. And it needs embedding as well through the training and so forth, again, as other people have been saying earlier. And I think it also needs reflecting in the monitoring. And I could say more about that later if you want, but I'll hand over to Caroline if you want.
Yeah, I completely agree that I think we discussed this in the last session about this the need for the language to be clearer so that developers were clear about what wasn't allowed and what they couldn't push on, and local authorities had the support then to refuse applications and confident that they wouldn't lose on appeal and have a cost awarded against them. So I think there is still a need for clarity. I think we're much closer than we were, because it's much clearer that significant weight must be given, and there aren't those kind of except emissions must be reduced, except where they can't be, kind of, that's gone. So that's really helpful. But I think it's still going to be that test of, in practice, are local authorities confident enough to refuse significant developments because they've weighted that as their deciding factor? Yeah.
Thanks very much for that. I'm going to move on to questions from Miles Griffins. It's been a long morning. Merging my colleagues. Mark Griffin, who's joining us online.
Thanks, Kavina. Similar vein to the question I've asked the previous panels. You know, there's been considerable emphasis in Parliament and in government on focusing on economic growth. And I just wanted to ask witnesses, they're confident that that is compatible with the approach to planning as set out in the draft NPF4 document.
Thank you. The principle of you know, the NPF supporting development is still there, and of course development is one of the things that is, you know, synonymous with economic growth. So I don't have any concerns that this is going too far in regulating against development and not supporting economic growth. I am one of the people that was very critical of the previous kind of sustainable economic growth kind of fudge. So I'm a bit happier, I think, with this version, which does prioritise the environmental principles and the environmental goals, but still allows for growth. It doesn't legislate against that at all. So I don't think there's a problem.
Yeah. I think similar thing. I mean, the sustainable economic growth definition that we had failed to mention either resources or conservation. Neither of those two words came in the definition, which made it a rather peculiar way of approaching the notion of sustainability. But I think probably more could be done, actually, with NPF4, and particularly when we come to the regional spatial strategies in terms of delivering different types of growth. I mean, I think we're all in favour of growth and well-being as long as it's in an appropriate form. And where I did actually run the draft past a colleague in South Africa, an academic there, and he did actually feel that it was light on the productive places side. But I think some of that is because it's tucked into the what's now the appendix on the different regional strategies. I think just to take, you know, one illustration, I think we need to look at what the spatial dimension is of things like circular economy, and, you know, what are the spatial catchments for key growth areas in recycling, and where do you locate them, and how do we progress them through the system? So I think more probably does need to be done. But really shining a spatial analysis angle on it and grasping again the potential of community wealth building is contributing to economic growth. by recycling the investment and returns rather than seeing it extracted.
Okay. That's an interesting point on that. I think, Mark, you're done with your questions, yeah? Okay, we're now going to move on to questions from Marie McNair.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. It's the same line of questions from the other two panels. Dr. Brown, I'd like to ask if you're satisfied that the terms such as community wealth building and 20-minute neighbourhoods are now significantly well-defined and understood to provide a robust basis for planning decision-making. So just really keen to hear your views on this.
As others have commented previously, I think we've come a long way from the previous version, so it's much clearer what we mean here. And I notice also that some of the language around 20-minute neighbourhoods has kind of been, if you like, drawn back in underneath the place principle rather than as the headline. I think that's also helpful, allowing us to kind of think about and articulate the nuances of different contexts. So the someone was saying earlier, you know, the urban, the suburban, the rural, the island contexts are really important, and having policies which are flexible enough to allow planners and practitioners to interpret that in those contexts, I think is really helpful. So I think we've moved much closer. I don't think community wealth building is quite there yet. I think there's still lots of questions around that. And as we've seen in previous discussions, you know, people are saying this is quite a new concept in industry. It's quite a new concept in local authorities. So I think there's always room for more elaboration, and particularly on that quite new use of language, quite new idea. So 20-minute neighbourhoods, I think, is much clearer, because there's a lot more work around that and a lot more understanding. But the community wealth building is clearer than it was, but still room for further elaboration. And that may come in separate documents rather than within the NPF itself.
Thank you.
There's needs for follow-ups and advice and research. I think 20-minute neighbourhood remains a little bit more problematic than perhaps Caroline's suggesting. Again, I said there's international interest in what's being done here, and I got an email last week from distinguished German spatial planning professor Klaus Kunzmann saying, look, I've just seen the Scottish MPF4 and what it's saying about community wealth building. I've got a blog on this that I've done in German, but I'll translate it into English if you want, and can you publish it on your website? So that's what I did. And what Klaus argues is, firstly, that it was a kind of political ploy in Paris by Anne Hidalgo to mobilise support. But more fundamentally, that he argues that there's a risk that because similar people live in similar neighbourhoods, that you kind of trap poorer people in poorer neighbourhoods and wealthier people in wealthy neighbourhoods. And the more that key resources are concentrated in the neighbourhood, the more that social divide exists. I think what Klaus takes for granted, because he's based in Dortmund, is that you're in a large urban agglomeration. I think that risk is greater in the bigger cities, perhaps bigger than any we've got in Scotland, than it is particularly in the small towns, for example, where there is only one school, one secondary school, you know, where people are more likely to share for facilities. But I do think that needs looked at. And similarly, you know, what happens if one of the key local facilities isn't there? You know, if you know, how serious is it if there isn't a local health centre compared with, say, a local secondary school? So I think there's a number of issues still to be teased out on this. And in the context of local authority austerity, it's a real question mark about sustaining those essential services that can knit together the 20-minute neighbourhood in the ways it's seen. So I'm supportive, but I do think that it needs quite a lot of work, and every place is different, you know. It needs some sophisticated local understanding to deliver it to good effect.
Thank you for that. And the last question, obviously, was about, you know, the numerous references to the infrastructure first approach in the revised MPF4. And just to ask, really, has it been delivered in practice? If not, what needs to change?
Well, infrastructure first makes a lot of sense. I mean, one of the critiques we got of the previous system is it's been kind of infrastructure second or third or maybe later. And so it's integral to a planning approach, but it then, going back to where we were, it does mean there has to be confidence in the local development plans, that they have to be bold, they have to be leading documents, plan-led documents, and not things that are then overturned on appeal. And that also needs, though, the coordination of the infrastructure providers and the different sections of Scottish Government. I very much liked Table 1, I think what people call in the matrix. I thought that was really good, not least because it connected with the Sustainable Development Goals and carried things through. And it seems to me that, you know, I would say this as a planner, wouldn't I? That planners can see that everything affects everything else. I just hope that we can get to a situation where the sectoral providers, whether it be health, transport, environment, whatever, can also see that everything affects everything else and you need a plan to put it together. And I think one of the acid tests will be how you can actually make that infrastructure first idea work across the system through the different types of plans we've now got with regional spatial strategies. I'm still not totally convinced about the city-region deals, how far they really tie into that rather than into a couple of priorities of really key big players. You know, I think there's a lot of alignment still to be done, but at least the MPF4, this iteration, more than any of the previous three, is trying to do that, and I give credit for that.
Thank you, Dr. Brown.
So lots of things that Cliff has already said I would agree with, and I think infrastructure first, I remember that we talked about this last time as well. I'm really supportive of this, but I'm also really supportive of the infrastructure-led development. And there's a question there about whether or not the resource is there to deliver infrastructure ahead of development. So particularly doing that longer-term planning thing where we're saying we're going to be expanding this settlement, you know, on the eastern edge, and we're going to put in now those corridors for the public transport bus links and for the cycling and walking infrastructure, and we're going to put that infrastructure in even though the houses in that area aren't going to be there for maybe 5 or 10 more years. And I think there's still a question about the ability of local government and the Scottish Government to do that and to deliver it. So infrastructure first is a really important idea, but I think we still haven't yet seen it being delivered convincingly in practice, and we do not see in Scotland infrastructure first, infrastructure-led development in a way that some other countries do manage to do. So still some questions for me about that one.
Thank you.
Yeah, some interesting points there, and definitely big questions on that infrastructure-led development. I think that's an interesting perspective. We're now going to go online with Annie Wells.
Thank you, convener. Good afternoon, panel. I'm going to go back to the sort of a question asked to the other panels, which is about the every local place plan and it having to have regard to NPF4. Now, looking at the draft document, how confident are you that community bodies will be able to do this? But also from the last panel, is how do we reach out to these community bodies? And where there's communities that don't have any community bodies, like where I come from quite a deprived area in Glasgow, we don't have that community cohesion or bodies that are there to do this. So how do we get communities involved in this? That's to either first.
the best way to get communities involved is to have a threat. That always puts people on the streets and into public meetings. But more seriously, I think the planning system does remain quite daunting to people. I have to declare interest as being a patron of PAS, Planning Aid Scotland, as was. So I think PAS has done a good job of trying to provide facilitating support, but it again needs backing. And also, you know, from the point of view of being chair of the Coburn Association, again, I'm very conscious here in Edinburgh, even in Edinburgh, where there's obviously a lot of resource and expertise within community groups, that a lot of groups still do find the system difficult to mm-hmm. to negotiate. And you know, we get loads of people phoning up the Coburn Association saying X, Y, Z is happening, can you help? And you know, very often it's too late because they get involved at the point where the application is there at the bottom of the street, but it's already gone through the local development plan and MPF process. But also, you know, as a small charity, you know, we're now finding life very difficult. Our energy bills have gone up, our staffing costs have gone up. The cost of living crisis means that our membership, you know, we're delighted to say, is holding steady. But, you know, we haven't really got the capacity to provide the help that we could provide if we had a bit more resource there that we could draw upon. So I do think that local place plans need to be resourced. They need to be able to tap into the expertise that is in communities and find ways to make that effective in terms of connecting with the issues on the ground.
So I think there's two elements to this. One you started off with is about the way in which the local place plans interact with NPF4. And I think NPF4 is a lot clearer than it was, and it's a lot easier to understand. But I think the idea of there being a simplified mm-hmm. layperson's version, I think, would be really helpful to distill this even further down, and that would make it easier for local place plans of communities on the ground to see how what they're thinking about in their place would link through to the principles in NPF4. So I think there's some technical, practical work to be done about NPF4 and how it links up with the local place plan. But I think this other question about getting community involvement is also predicated on the purpose of the local place plan and being able to convince people that there is something to be gained in the community from buying into it, and something to be gained which is not just saying, no, we don't want that housing, retail park, nuclear power station or whatever it is to pop up in that part of our neighbourhood, but is actually much more positive about the future. And I think that's the trick that we need to master. I don't think we're there. There is definitely a requirement for resourcing and skills development in local authorities and with outreach, whether that's coming through PAS or another organisation into communities to help them to do it. But we also can't force communities, that's the other thing. So we have to, it's a little bit of a tightrope, you know, to how to communicate that and support it for communities that want to do it and get to a place where we're able to articulate the value of it. What are they going to get out? What's going to be the upshot for them? And something that's much more positive than just stopping this bad thing that they're worried about.
Yeah. Just to add, I do think there's a leadership role here. I think we need to have high-profile statements that, yeah, you know, this is a change in the way the planning system is going to work. We're about climate change, net zero, biodiversity, and this is really going to be reflected through the system. And I think if you start talking in those terms and put your monitoring indicators as well as a key list, you can begin to turn around this image that what we've got is a process-driven bureaucratic system that is impenetrable for the ordinary person, and that is really dominated by the KCs and the big investors. And if we can begin to show that through using the planning system with the local place plans, you can actually enhance your local biodiversity. Using the planning system and the local place plans, you can explore the concept of community wealth building and see local benefits from it. I think you could begin to change the way that involvement is seen.
Thank you, I find that very helpful. Thank you both, and thank you, convener.
Thanks. Yes, I think there's an opportunity for some well-skilled community facilitators around that. It's kind of very interesting that how to pull community wealth building through local place plans. It's kind of exciting work to be done. We're now going to move to questions from Paul McClellan.
Yes, thank you, convener. And good afternoon, panel. I'm going to ask the same questions that I asked the previous two panels. It was on your views on the delivery programme, obviously accompanies NPF 4, including the establishment of the Planning Infrastructure in Place Advisory Group. And one of the key things, the other question was really just asking about, are there one of the key things we were keen to focus on was in regards to monitoring the effectiveness of NPF 4. So are there any indicators that you would like to see as part of that? And I'll probably come to yourself, Professor Haig, first of all.
Yeah, it really follows on from what I was just saying. Yeah. I would scrap the stakeholder group of applicants. Why I would do that is because I don't think the primary aim of MPF4 is to speed up the rate at which planning decisions are taken. I'm not saying that doesn't matter. I'm not saying that we should slow down decisions. I'm just saying that's not climate change. That's not net zero. That's not biodiversity. So why do we prioritise that? Going back on the previous question, when you start saying that the key stakeholders are applicants, where does that leave everybody else? It sends a message, you're on the outside. So I would suggest that we have a citizen stakeholder group, but they're serviced by some expert professionals, by the people who can actually talk serious science on carbon reduction, by the people who know what the impact is on biodiversity, and feed that in and help them interrogate the annual data that will be provided by Scottish Government. I'd also go for some hopefully eye-catching summative headline indicators. So, for example, for sustainable places, could we look at something like the area of peat restored in the last year? You know, tell people that the planning system is about protecting peatlands, because that really matters. Could we, for livable places, look at the number of buildings demolished in the past year and hopefully see that declining, because we know the most sustainable building is an existing building? Could we talk about an indicator on the percentage of new buildings, new developments that have got sustainable urban drainage systems that's approved, so that we begin to see the way that the planning system is influencing development for the good? I've already mentioned the issue around affordable housing. Could we see that as a key indicator of the system, that we increase the number of truly affordable housing? I'd also like to see something on homelessness. On productive places, percentage of empty town centre properties, hopefully going down. The number of facilities approved in development proposals for all forms of renewable, low carbon and zero emission technologies, and so on. So I think, you know, if we get a select group of indicators backed by know-how, feeding through citizen groups, you know, we could begin to change things, not just run it forward in the way we had done in the past.
Thanks, Professor Haig. Dr. Brown, same question.
Thank you. It's quite a complicated question, isn't it? I think on the delivery plan, as others have said, it's very useful that we had this separate document, and it set out a lot of the kind of plans around different groups and monitoring and things. It does look terribly complicated and quite resource intensive. And I suppose I think Cliff's alluded to the fact that perhaps there's room for changing the focus of that, the makeup of those groups, and, you know, are they doing, are they reflecting the things that we want them to reflect? So that's the first thing. As others have said in previous panels, I think there are loads of questions about the resource available to deliver this. And I think that also needs to be part of the monitoring. So to look at the resources that are being put into the implementation of the national projects, for example. So how much is being delivered? How much budget has been allocated and what has actually been delivered on the ground? And in line with what Cliff was saying, you know, that actually helps to tell a story about what the national planning framework is helping to deliver on the ground. And I think that would be really helpful to know. I think there might also be some value in doing some work looking back at what has previously been delivered by NPF3 and that national level planning. So that's one part of it. So we've talked about the delivery bodies and the sort of monitoring in here, the groups in here. We've talked about the resourcing and I think staffing. People have talked about the number of planners. I know there's work ongoing around bringing more people into the planning profession. I think that would be an easy something to monitor to see actually do we actually have more planners within the Scottish Government, within local authorities, helping to do these things and implement this new revised NPF4. And then there's a series of questions about the sort of monitoring of the impact and the difference. And I think Cliff's given us some really nice ideas there. The delivery programme also has some indicators in it, but I don't think they quite get at the what's changed. And I think this is also a really tricky question without having some clear baselines about what the current carbon intensity of housing developments is, as opposed to the future carbon intensity of schemes coming through the system. And I think that's hard. That's quite hard, but I think, again, there's some room for thinking about that. So biodiversity would be another one, again, as kind of a high-level objective of NPF4. You know, how do we measure that impact of the new policies on developments that are coming through the system and are consented under the new arrangements versus things that were consented in the past? But I think there's also something about only focusing on development that comes through the system and what the old ones look like and what the new ones look like. But we also need to look at these wider measures of place and quality, because NPF4 sets the agenda for those as well. So it isn't just about new housing and new retail, it's about those other improvements. And again, can we create any indicators which capture that community level? There's been quite a bit of work around 20-minute neighbourhood potential, and maybe that would give another opportunity for a baseline about what the current potential is, and then in the future, are we actually seeing more areas with greater potential for 20-minute neighbourhoods because these policies are having an effect? So I think that's enough for the moment.
That's both very helpful for that.
One thing.
Sorry. But one quote, at a national level, monitoring will initially focus on reviewing appeal decisions and reflecting on the progress of new LDPs in the local development plans in the system, end quote. You know, young people concerned about the future of the planet are not going around saying, let's monitor how the LDPs are progressing. Let's monitor the appeal system. You know, that they're matters for the bureaucrats. If you wonder why people see planning as bureaucratic, it's because the sentence is like that. It's because this is the inside game that's being played rather than looking at what we're really trying to do.
Yeah, I think our challenge, obviously, is to monitor just some of the things that you've suggested and go deeper beyond that. And that's the role of this committee. So that's been very helpful. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you for that. So we know where we're going. We've got we maybe got four more questions, but I'm going to pass over to Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. I'll try to cut mine down to just two. I wanted to ask, in terms of both the climate and nature crisis, it's quite clear from your opinion that's been captured within NPF4. Do you think, in relation to the housing crisis, that should also be very much on the face of the plan as well?
Yeah, I do. But let's define the housing crisis. It's partly a crisis of homelessness, which doesn't get a mention. And it's particularly a crisis of affordability, and there are spatial differences in that, as you've already mentioned, that, you know, the Edinburgh situation. So yes, it's there, but you have to get serious about what we mean by affordability. You have to rethink the notion that build-to-rent is actually about making housing more affordable. I mean, if you had £10,000 to invest, would you put it in build-to-rent if you thought rents were going to become more affordable, or if you thought rents were going to be continue to escalate? So I think that's quite a crucial point. Also, I think we need to recognise, hopefully here in Edinburgh, that we are going to reclaim a number of probably thousands of houses that were lost to investors in short-term lets, which were done, as we know, without the change of use and the new control zone that's now been stated. But yes, I would see particularly social housing as essential national infrastructure, because you need it for social reasons, but you also need it for economic reasons. You know, if you can't get people affordable housing close to work who are on low incomes, you begin to have knock-on effects in labour supply, etc., as we all know, in the economic system. So it's not an either-or. But yes, I would support that idea.
What he said, yeah. Definitely. I mean, we talked last time about short-term lets and some of those things, the unintended consequences of, you know, things happening in the world which affected the housing market, particularly in Edinburgh, but in other bits of Scotland as well. We know the islands are very affected by some of that. So there's always room to do more. And to echo some of the thoughts of previous speakers, NPF 4 can't do everything. So NPF 4 sets the kind of policy context for housing, but is not responsible itself for housing delivery. And, you know, having good social housing provided for paid for by local authorities in Scotland, you know, is another mechanism for helping to resolve this. So there's always a lot more to do, and there's a lot of nuance, I think, around housing that maybe isn't reflected in here in the fullest extent, but we have to also recognise the limitations of what NPF4 can do.
No, that's helpful. I would like to go into lots of detail about data sets, but I don't think we've got time to do that necessarily today, but it'd be helpful to get your opinions beyond this on where that currently is within NPF4. And my final question was returning to something you raised earlier, Professor Haig, with regards to gender, because I was interested, and I think by and large many of the comments we've received as a committee point towards what is often a male-dominated industry, and then decisions taken, not necessarily taking into account other views, basically, especially with regards to street layout, lighting, things like that. That's been raised with us on several occasions. So I just wondered, do you think the policies in the revised NPF 4 will actually deliver on a built environment that meets the needs of women, children and disabled people?
Again, I think it's a start on where we're at, but this is, again, one of the areas where it needs continuing leadership. It needs people saying these are material considerations, these are things that we're taking seriously, and it needs to feed into the training and so forth as well. But it's a step in the right direction, and there are, of course, other inequalities that also need to be tied together on that.
I could say quite a lot on this, and I mentioned at the beginning that I thought one of the changes has been to thread equalities into specific policies in a much more effective way than in the previous version. So I think that is a really helpful thing. But we have to be clear that the responsibility here is on the planners and the professionals within the system to implement the policies. It's not on women in the community or disabled people to come forward and say what is wrong and what needs to be fixed. So I think that's a really important thing. I think there was in one place something about women. I can't remember. I'll have to look it up. But there was one moment that I thought, we have to recognise the current inequalities and address them. And I think this is goes a little bit further than what's in here. So, for example, if we look at active travel, we know that men are cycling twice as much as women in Scotland. And why is that? And we know from research that women are more risk averse and they feel that the current cycle infrastructure does not meet their needs. And that might be because some of the things on offer are off-road paths. I can just thinking through Holyrood Park here, there's some lovely off-road paths that women tend not to find attractive and safe, particularly on a dark afternoon or at night. So the women are forced to make a choice between a personal risk, so personal safety risk, versus traffic safety risk. And that is something we have to understand and address in our design. Cycling by Design does quite a good job on that, so that has been revised, but designing streets is still outstanding, and the revision to designing streets needs to address these things more clearly to explain how existing patterns of development affect particular groups, and then the sorts of designs which overcome those problems for women, for people with disabilities, for people with different types of needs, you know, whether that's a mobility impairment or a visual impairment or whatever. So I think we're still looking for some of that guidance to catch up with where we need to be. So I think it is really helpful what's in here, but we still could go much further. And just on children, I really liked the policy on play, and one of my kind of asks in relation to delivery and perhaps monitoring is looking at designing streets and how that articulates how to build play into new streets. So the policy is really clear that new developments, new neighbourhoods, new streets should make play accessible for independent mobility for children and make it accessible. But we need to have the guidance and the exemplars in there so that out in the world, so that practitioners can see what it looks like and then deliver it.
Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thanks very much, Miles, and thanks for those responses there. I'm going to now move to Willie Coffey, who's been patiently waiting.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to you, and I'm really glad that you've widened the discussion out. Some of the issues that concern me as a local member and have done for many years, I suppose I was very hopeful that they would be solved within NPF4, and I'd like to get your views on whether you think they are. Professor Haig, you talked about things like derelict buildings and empty shops and offshore retail owners and the inability perhaps to reach out to those bits of society to get them to play their part. That's very much a hope that I had for NPF4, that we would be able to reach some of this stuff. If you look around any town, city, town or village in Scotland, you'll see examples of this all over the place. Urban dereliction and decay, abandoned shops, abandoned land, absentee owners, absentee shareholders, whoever they may be. And I thought to myself, where's the role for NPF4 in addressing that big issue? Because that's what matters to my citizens and my constituency. And you talked about maybe we should have citizens, stakeholders to see a sort of bottom-up approach and solution to this. So could you give us some views about whether it was too much to expect NPF4 to address that, and what could we do additionally to help NPF4 to reach that sort of problem in the urban setting?
Yeah, I think it probably is too much to expect NPF4, you know, to repopulate the town centres of small towns across Scotland. It is a national strategy. And it is, you know, setting the framework, as it says. But I think that the issue is best tackled actually at local level. I think NPF4, you know, sets the direction. It raises the issues we've already been talking about this morning, which are helpful. I did some work when I was chair of Built Environment Forum Scotland on particularly smaller towns in Scotland. And in every case, virtually, I think there was a challenge in the town centre. And you have to understand those local situations, I think. You know, how cohesive are the local traders? Which properties are owned by local companies, firms, and which are owned by, you know, branches of global investors? Because one thing that struck me was that where you've got a local owner who's renting it out to a shopkeeper or whatever, they were much more realistic about rent levels in some of these places than what you got from the, you know, decisions that were being taken by an algorithm in Middlesex or something. So you also need to see, I think, you know, just what is the condition and the nature of the buildings. But crucially, the public sector still has a really big role to play. And one of the difficulties that we've hit over the last 10, 15 years or so is, you know, loss of key public buildings like district courts, which tend to operate to have a prominent building in the centre. That, of course, the loss of the old town halls, going back to the 1970s, but still felt. And more recently, the relocation of some council offices to new build, in some cases, edge city sites, edge town sites, leaving behind your property in the centre, which then becomes empty. And has, again, this rundown effect, because these are prominent buildings. You know, town halls were making a statement about how important the town was. So they weren't sort of little side things. So I think you've got to have some sort of agency at local level that will do the legwork, do the trade connecting, try and come up with feasible strategies, explore where there's scope for new investment. It's not going to be easy, because we know, you know, e-retailing, the cost of living crisis, there's a whole range of things that are going to be hard to overcome. But I think unless you've got that sort of feet on the ground with the local know-how, the vision and the ability to network across different stakeholders, it's going to be even more difficult. But if we can do that, I think it could be really transformative.
Dr. Brink.
Yeah. I agree with lots of things that Cliff has talked about, and I just wanted to mention the Scottish Land Commission's work, because they've done lots of stuff around vacant and derelict land, and some of the things that they've proposed there about, you know, which would give local authorities tools to actually, you know, acquire assets and bring them back into use and bring them back to development. And of course, I think this issue also intersects with the policies around community wealth building and obviously community sort of assets transfer. So those possibilities for communities to acquire those sites and to turn them from a derelict bank or whatever it is into some community hub. I mean, you know, there's quite a few examples of that. And I think that's a really positive part of this. So to see those, the support there in NPF for that in the policy, but the tools itself are not delivered by NPF4. I think there are some other tools that sit alongside. If they don't already, they should be coming forward through some of those other initiatives, like the ones Scottish Land Commission have proposed. So, yeah.
It's that. Again, in theory, you know, one of the advantages of decline is property becomes cheap, so it becomes easier to get in. So, you know, we really need to try and look at how you can use easy in, easy out, cheap accommodation as a basis for startups and tapping, you know, local entrepreneurial capabilities, fostering that, leading it. You know, but it does demand this willingness to actually think beyond, are we going to approve a planning application within 8 weeks?
Yeah, it's that very issue that I find is really difficult to answer. If an old building, perhaps, in a town like Kilmarnock, for example, has several purposes over many years, and perhaps there's an application to use it in some new purpose or other that we might collectively, our elected members or the citizens of the town, might not agree with, planners feel impeded and changing the mind if it's already provided for that particular change of use. How do we inject that kind of sense of we think differently about what the town should be and what that building should be used for in NPF4? I don't see it in there. And I don't think, having discussed these issues with local planners, that they feel they have the ability to do that. So who should do it? Should it be your citizen stakeholder group and pushing from the bottom up? Or should it be some other mechanism? I'm trying to to get to?
ICE plan, which might help you. I think there are these other policies around the community assets and community wealth building and the wellbeing economy and also 20-minute neighbourhoods, which also could support, you know, the kind of alternative community visions for what a place could be and what buildings could be used for. So, no, we don't want this bowling alley or whatever. What we want is a community hub where people can do this and this and this. And I have seen several of those sorts of, you know, things coming forward. So community groups saying, we need a hub. We need something that can be used by families in the day with small children, that older people can come and keep warm and have a coffee and a natter, can be used for after school activities or evening classes. These sorts of things, I think, there are policies here which could support that, but the mechanisms, the resources for doing it are perhaps the missing part of the jigsaw. So,
yeah. I think MPF4 kind of enhances the potential value of all existing buildings because of the net zero commitment and the thing I said earlier, you know, the existing building is the most sustainable building. Mm-hmm. So in principle, it should give a higher priority to finding new uses for existing buildings. Having said all that, the downside is, you know, it can be very complex and you need a coherent business plan. I mean, there's only so many community hubs you can keep going, you know. The tragedy is that enthusiasts can get drawn into something with what seems like a nice idea and they're going to run a cafe or whatever it is. But, you know, it really needs also a coherent business plan behind it, or else you're just setting some people up to fail. So it's, again, you know, we need these kind of dynamic local actors. And I think they can be from different situations. They may be planners, they may be councillors. It may depend on the local situation. You know, in the end, you know, my Scandinavian friends talk about souls on fire. And that's what you need. Somebody who's daft enough, committed enough, thinks outside the box enough to make something happen. And what we need to do, what councillors need to do, and what planners need to do is to be engaged with those people and, you know, supportive and sympathetic. And I go back, there's a lot of expertise in communities, in many of them. It's not evenly spread. But, I mean, I find with the Coburn, you know, we've got people on the Coburn who know more about some things than people in the council do, right? No. We need to find ways to bring that type of expertise into a more positive relationship with local authorities across Scotland.
Thank you so much for that. I love that phrase, that souls on fire. We need many more of them locally and across Scotland, I think. Thank you. Thanks for that, Convener.
Yeah, thank you, Willie, for that question. So that brings our questions to the end. And I just want to say thank you so much for joining us this morning. Actually, we've moved into the afternoon. And for opening up the conversation, broadening the topic. We'll be continuing our evidence taking on MPF4 at next week's meeting, where we'll hear from the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth. And I now suspend the meeting briefly so our witnesses can leave. The third item on our agenda today is to consider a negative instrument, the Assured Tenancy and Private Residential Tenancies Prescribed Notices and Forms, Miscellaneous Temporary Modifications Scotland Regulations 2022. As this is a negative instrument, there is no requirement for the committee to make any recommendation on it. Members will note that the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee reported the instrument to the Parliament on the grounds that it failed to comply with laying requirements in terms of timings. However, the Delegated Powers Committee was content with the Scottish Government's explanation of the reasons for this breach. Do members have any comments on the instrument? Our members agreed that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument. Agreed. Thank you. We agreed at the start of this meeting to take the next two items in private. So as we have no more public business today, I now close the public part of the meeting.